That's okay. I think we're ready to reconvene. Okay, we're on. All right, good evening, everyone. We're going to reconvene and go into our regular meeting agenda today. It is Thursday. I didn't announce that before. And it is March 16th. I didn't announce that either, in case you didn't know. And it is currently 6:30, and we're going to go into our regular council meeting. I didn't say this before, but I'll say it now. Diane, please let the record show that all members of council are present. We've already done our Pledge of Allegiance and our moment of silence. And with that, we'll start the meeting with a proclamation. It's proclamation time here in Walpole Beach. Whereas the state of Florida officially recognizes March as Bicycle Month, and whereas residents and visitors to the village of Walpole Beach enjoy safe, environmentally friendly alternative methods of transportation that provide access to public and private facilities such as parks, schools, Palmtran bus stops, and businesses. And whereas the state of Florida designates March as Bicycle Month, and Palm Beach County will recognize it locally, and whereas the village of Walpole Beach encourages the safe use of bicycles on non-motorized transportation, as a non-motorized transportation, and whereas the village of Walpole Beach is committed to providing the accessibility, connectivity, safety of non-motorized transportation throughout the village by constructing and maintaining 60.2 miles of paved shared use pathways. And whereas the local recognition of Bicycle Month in the village of Walpole Beach will increase awareness of alternative transportation options throughout the village while promoting the health benefits of bicycling along with reducing traffic congestion, and ultimately popularize bicycling as a viable, attractive alternative mode of transportation. Now therefore, I as mayor of the village of Walpole Beach hereby proclaim March 2023 as Walpole Beach Bicycle Month, and encourage all residents and visitors to safely explore the convenience and benefits of bicycling as an alternative to motorized transportation throughout the village. Signed and sealed the 16th day of March, 2023. So I guess after this, we all need to do some bicycling, right? So is there an event that we can bring our bikes out to?
There is.
As a matter of fact, you're going to report on that? Okay, I knew you would. See? Yeah, you got all bases covered. Put this out of it. Okay. Having done the proclamation, it's now for reports. And we'll start with you, Selena, if you're going to tell us something about bicycling.
I will. Okay. Thank you. Real quick, once again, I would like to pass on the condolences to the Hochman family. Stan is going to be missed. We were talking about that in the office, not just for the work that he did, but his personality and his smiling face. So I'm going to miss that. I am. We attended Westfest. We had that coming up, so it's great to see that that annual event is back now. So I look forward to that expanding. We went to baseball opening day, so congratulations to all the teams out there. There was an expansion, so we had more girls softball teams. And we also did recognize our state champion softball team again out there. Young at Heart was great. There was a DJ that focused on line dancing. So it was great. Everybody getting up and doing, yeah, all different line dances. So it was great. I did my one that I knew and got off quickly. Yeah, that's it. Upcoming, we have our seafood festival this Saturday and Sunday over at Commons Park. We have the family bike rodeo on Saturday the 25th. Ah. Registration begins at 8 a.m. And the green markets are also on Saturdays outside through the month of the rest of March and in April, 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. And we do have a strategic planning session coming up. So it's the week of the 27th of March, and that's with the staff and council and everybody. So just a reminder that how we know what to plan and what residents want is when they tell us. So here's a great time as we're going through that planning stage now, so we're ready for the next fiscal year. So please reach out to all of us and let us know what you want and your thoughts as we have different items coming up. And March is also Women's History Month. So that completes my report.
Okay. That's a good reminder.
March is also NCAA basketball tournament starting time. And
It started today.
A couple, at least one upset I saw, which was nice.
That means your bracket is busted already?
No. Hopefully there'll be another upset tomorrow night, because for the first time in over two decades, FAU's basketball team is back in the big dance, so hopefully, and
go FAU.
And my, according to my son, their coach May was named the coach of the year.
When do they play?
They play like it's at like 9 o'clock tomorrow night, tomorrow, so it's a little late tomorrow. But
this is a Friday, so
yeah, exactly. But hey, go Owls. Okay. That's all I gotta say.
Go Owls.
All right, I'll root for them. I know somebody
it rolls off your tongue, doesn't it? Go Owls.
Get it?
Yep.
Okay.
Speaking of schools, we had our Education Advisory Board meeting for the month of March this past Monday, and H.L. Johnson Elementary was the showcase school. Principal Crystal Amato Kurchowski introduced the cheerleading team, and they put on a heck of a show. But typically, when the elementary schools show up and the kids show up, the parking lot's full. The place is standing room only. And when they're done, we're back to the usual crowd, which is mostly the board, the members of the education community. And we had a good turnout. The kids were fantastic, as always. So there were a couple of things that principal talked about. One of them was that the average years of teaching experience at H.L. Johnson Elementary is 14.9 years. And the average tenure is 11.5 years. So there's a lot of staying power and a lot of educational expertise over there. H.L. Johnson is currently an A-rated school, has 819 students, and that grew from 768 in 2021 to the 819 that they have there now. They're actually doing construction to increase capacity of that school. H.L. Johnson offers two choice programs, a STEAM program, as well as the Cambridge International program, and with Crestwood Middle School having a Cambridge International program, an ACE program, there is now a K through 12 continuum available for that remarkable international program throughout all of Royal Palm Beach. So we're very fortunate to have that quality education here. H.L. Johnson is the first school in Palm Beach County to be issued a grower's permit. They actually have a garden place out in back, and they've had it there for a number of years. This is going to be the first year that they're actually going to sell some of their produce at our green market. How about that, huh? Nice connection.
Got to show up for that.
Yeah, absolutely. H.L. Johnson is currently undergoing a lot of improvements. I mentioned that they're doing a lot of internal work, but also some serious construction work. The faculty and administration has done an amazing job. They actually have a mechanism for soliciting students and parents, faculty and stakeholders across the board for input, and they take a very aggressive approach. So anything that scores below 90 is immediately acted upon with specific plans to target those areas. So Principal Kucharski has an outstanding school over there. She continues with the reputation that started many years ago and is taking it up another level. There's a notice that I wanted to share with everybody, and that it's parents and family. Kindergarten Roundup for Royal Palm Beach Elementary Schools, all three of them, is on April the 12th. And you can find the details of information about that at palmbeachschools.org/kindergarten. So you might want to check into that. Crestwood Middle School had their multicultural assembly today. It's an annual event, and they celebrate their 34 different cultural backgrounds that their students represent at the school. They base it on their performing arts program, and they've got a really amazing group there of kids that do everything from jazz to cheerleading to visual arts as well. In fact, I want to go over and check out their visual arts department. They've got a really high energy teacher over there, and she's come up with great stuff. And so we celebrated all of the different cultures that are represented by the kids who go to that school. And it was an interesting and a lot of fun kind of a thing. They wanted to make sure they kept the energy up high. So the last act was a mariachi band, and there wasn't anybody sitting down. That was absolutely great. And of course, as we normally come to expect, Marsh Andrews, our school board member, was there as well. So Saturday, April the 1st, not this coming Saturday, but next Saturday, the Education Advisory Board will interview 13 students for this year's Village Scholarships Award, and the council will recognize the 10 recipients and present the checks at the May council meeting. Somewhat school related was this past Saturday, the American Cancer Society had its annual Relay for Life. And of course, that's been less expansive over the pandemic period, but it seems to be back in full bloom with 85 teams that actually registered and participated, walking the track continuously from 4 o'clock to 9 o'clock, so they've shortened the time period. And they raised a record amount of money, $160,000 in this Relay for Life. So very remarkable and very much appreciated. Most of the Royal Palm Beach schools were actually there in large numbers, as a matter of fact. So that was a community event of a different kind. Today I sat in for the mayor at TPA's meeting, the agenda was mostly about what TPA is all about, Transportation Planning Agency, planning. It turns out that they're in the process of doing the long-range plan, the LRTP, and vision for 2050. Even hard to imagine we're talking about that. And somebody wanted to really shock us, said, you do realize that that's halfway to the next millennium. So if you like long-range planning, the Transportation Planning Agency is definitely involved in it. And of course, there was a lot of discussion about what kinds of things actually are going to influence future transportation here. And of course, growth is a major factor. But so is technology, and trying to anticipate things, but providing a flexible base is what this transportation vision for 2050 is really, really all about, trying to accommodate everything from, of course, the growth in electric vehicles to electronically connected vehicles with one another and the infrastructure, and autonomous vehicles. There's a scary thought, but in any case, these are all things that are actually being worked on. What was brought up was we here in Royal Palm Beach have seen a growth in electric scooters. And there are a lot of electric other vehicles, electric scooters, golf carts, electric bikes that are growing. And so all of that taken together is going to be part of this next long-range plan. It's a 25-year plan, and it gets updated every 5 years. So we talked a lot about that. There was a lot of discussion, as you can imagine. Get into that long range, everybody likes to put their visioning hat on it, and it's a good
exercise. I really believe the transportation landscape will be very different than from what it is now, and my vision is that we will reach a point out there where we really, every citizen will have a true option of saying, you know what, I don't need to take my car, there's plenty of other options here, you know, public options, etc., that will get me the way I want to go, when I want to get there, and do it safely.
Absolutely.
So to me, that planning that far out is, you have to be visionary, and you have to look at, you know, what things are going to be, which is not going to be as they are today. And I don't know. It's an interesting process, though.
It is, especially looking that far out, no doubt about it. But even in the five-year period, the Palm Beach Transportation Planning Agency has about $3.5 billion of state and federal transportation money
allocated.
That allocates. That's right. That's a big deal.
Yeah.
That's a big deal. So that completes my report.
Thank you. Okay.
Did they talk about flying cars?
Yes.
They did.
That's what I want.
That's being talked about now.
No, that's the mayor's favorite.
Yeah.
That's one of my favorites.
No, it's his
favorite. At some point, we're going to have to come up with an ordinance to regulate that in the village.
And that was discussed, and it wasn't. Nobody laughed.
It's true.
It's because it's good stuff.
Good Holly White.
Yeah.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. I had the. Why is my microphone so?
It's, I don't know. But it's you tonight. It's the voice.
I don't know. I was in Tallahassee last week for Palm Beach County Days to represent the village. I had the honor of talking with our lobbyists who are advocating on our behalf for two appropriations. The first one is the Canal System Rehabilitation Program. Yeah. And the second is the La Mancha roadway under drain.
Yeah.
Both Senator Harrell and Representative Roth have signed on to support both of those efforts. So that was really productive. Has everybody heard about the Let's Move Challenge? So the Let's Move Challenge is actually a countywide program. And they are encouraging citizens in all communities to participate. Now they got to us a little bit late, but I am connecting them with Lou and his team about the bike rodeo because they do, they'll go over, it's Digital Vibes, who's partnering with Palm Health Foundation. And Digital Vibes is a youth program that teaches music and dance and art and digital media. And so they'll go over on Bike Rodeo Day and set up a booth and encourage people to continue on the Let's Move, and they might bring music and all kinds of stuff. So, and then not to be outdone, you know, my Golden Flashes, Kent State University, is also in the NCAA.
Here we go.
So you know it's a unicorn year when these two teams are in. So they play tomorrow night at 9:55 against
Indiana.
But are
they in the same, they're in the same bracket?
Probably not.
No. All right, so that's, so far we're okay,
so,
right?
Yeah. So let's hope that's an upset.
Like 15 minutes of pain per hour.
Exactly.
Are you done? That's it? Okay. Great. What you got?
No report, Mayor. Thank you.
Okay. Keith.
Just briefly, we're in the session, and I'll give you a couple of highlights on some of the things. There's so many.
I know. It's action-packed session.
I just picked a few to bring to your attention. Sovereign immunity is back. It's House Bill 401, which proposes to raise from $200,000 per person, $300,000 per incident, to $2.5 million per person and $5 million per incident. That's a.
So this is really challenging at the current limit on exposure now for cities and counties.
Yep.
What does it look like? Is that going to happen?
It's early.
Ray's shaking his head. No.
It's
They've done this several times.
This is not the first.
It hasn't, and you hope it doesn't.
This. Yeah.
It's early in the committee process. It hasn't made it through any yet, so we'll hope. But it's back.
Okay.
The business damage ordinance is back. That's Senate Bill 170. That's the one that requires the business impact statement before adopting a new ordinance.
That's back?
Yeah.
Oh, boy. Okay.
Provides, you know, a mechanism for a business to challenge the ordinance. Provides for attorney's fees, which are capped at $50,000. The interesting thing that they did with this year, they amended this bill to also include what I'm calling the TESTA litigation notice fix. So there's a legislative fix for that lawsuit that dealt with advertising an ordinance on second reading and postponing it.
Yes.
So there's a legislative amendment that would propose to fix that and be retroactive in nature so that anything that happened in the past wouldn't be subject to challenge.
Okay.
So that's a good, that part of it's certainly
yeah.
good. There's the Live Local Act, that's Senate Bill 102. That's the one that deals with affordable housing. Big municipal preemption for placing affordable housing projects in a commercially zoned area would allow that to happen without getting development order approvals.
Really? That sounds like taking away some home rule.
This also provides certain tax credits and exemptions for affordable housing. That one actually has gotten through the Senate and it's been sent over to the House, so it's got some legs at the moment.
The tax credits are for the developers?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So there's another incentive.
Oh, and that bill also would, if it adopted in its current form, would completely prohibit any kind of local rent control at all. So,
home rule.
Just to clarify, there'd be no rent control, but they want to build affordable housing.
Right.
Just check things.
There's a vacation rental legislation again this year, House Bill 833. It's not actually a horrible bill this year. It clarifies that grandfathered cities can make revisions to their ordinance that are less restrictive without losing their grandfather status. It allows municipal vacation rental registration programs to include requiring the identification of a on-site property manager who's responsible for the property. That one's early in the process as well, but that was one of the bills that the Municipal Administration Committee made one of their priorities. And then the last one I'll mention is House Bill 37, which is the one that's the financial disclosure bill that's back this year that would require elected officials and managers to file Form 6.
Form 6, of Form yeah. 1. Right.
So that, and that's early in the committee process as well. So there's some highlights.
All right. Keep us posted.
We'll do.
Then move through the process.
Okay. That's my report, Mayor.
Okay. Thank you. I'd just like to make one bring up one item. I noticed on our master schedule, we're showing a council meeting for April 6th. Is that correct?
Yes.
I believe last year we moved that because the basic agenda issue had to do with timing of reappointments for the committees. Is that correct?
Yes. That's the whole purpose of the meeting.
I'd like to move that, those items to the, can we move that to the third week?
Yes, Bradford. Is there
I don't think there is.
Not scheduled. It would be a special meeting. We were trying to move the Tuttle project to the 18th or before the council meeting on the 20th to meet his time.
So wait a minute. We're asking for a special meeting for when?
Well, we haven't.
You haven't asked yet.
That has to be a request of you by the developer. If that request was made,
then we would have the meeting.
And you approved it, then we would have a planning and zoning board before the council meeting, without your ratification of the planning and zoning board, which would have to be done before they can meet.
Well, we can't ratify them. We can't move the date on the ratification. Just let them stay inactive in where they are now.
Leave the meeting where it is now?
No. They could have the meeting, but we would not require them to be recertified until when we met again, as opposed to having to do it before.
They wouldn't be members, though, would they?
The way the ordinance reads, Diane, you help me out here.
Okay, get
but
the parachute out, Keith.
I do believe
it wouldn't
that
be valid, right?
At the end of March, and this meeting is to accept their applications and to appoint them, and then because they have expired terms effective March 31st, so we don't have a planning and zoning board
technically
until you guys meet and okay. And accept.
You
want
to say something? It's only one member expiring.
So we can still have them.
So you still have a quorum.
Who is that?
The chairman.
David Leland.
All right. We have a vice chairman. Is there a vice chairman?
But you haven't had the request.
Okay. I'm not going to wait for the request. I think we should plan that. We don't plan on having that meeting on the 6th.
Not having it?
No. If a request comes through, we'll address it then.
Okay.
That makes sense? Do we need to vote on that, or?
Is that a consensus,
put it
or?
On a calendar that we would have it. When we did the council calendar, we identified the first.
And the council approved the calendar?
Yes, please,
a motion would be appropriate.
All right, follow for a motion then.
I make a motion to move the agenda from the April 6th meeting to the April 20th meeting.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? We have no opposed. Okay, Dan, let the record show that request for moving the meeting was approved 5-0. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, at this time, if anyone has a petition to present to the council, now would be the time to present it. Seeing none. All right, no. So I'm closing the floor to petitions for the evening. Now we'll look for statements from the public on non-agenda items or items on the consent agenda. Diane, we had any advance requests?
No,
ma'am. Ray, do we have anyone with their hand up out there? Is anyone out there?
Yes.
So
We're still living in the post-COVID world. This is the way it's going to be. This is the way it is now. No hands are raised? Okay. I have not received any comment cards for non-agenda items or for items on the consent agenda. So with that, I'm closing the floor to non-agenda items and consent agenda items, public comments. Diane, please give us the consent agenda.
Yes, Mayor, I will. Thank you. Number one, approval of the minutes of the council regular meeting of February 16th, 2023. Two, approval and authorization for the mayor to execute an interlocal agreement between Palm Beach County and the Village of Royal Palm Beach, providing for traffic control jurisdiction with the Village of Royal Palm Beach by Palm Beach County in terms pertaining to the upgrade of the Royal Palm Beach Elementary School Zone traffic control devices. Three, approval and authorization in accordance with established policy to make a budget amendment for Fund 303 in the fiscal year 2022-2023 budget. Said amendment to transfer a total of $150,000 from fund balance 303 to new project EN2306, Royal Palm Beach Elementary School Zone. Four, fiscal year 2022 annual comprehensive financial report. Five, approval of a special event permit for the Village of Royal Palm Beach to hold a garage sale at Village Hall, where the Green Market is held on Sunday, April 2nd, 2023, from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. Six, approval of a special event permit for the Village of Royal Palm Beach to hold a cultural diversity day at Veterans Park on Saturday, May 13th, 2023, from 1 p.m. to 9 p.m. Seven, approval of a special event permit for the Village of Royal Palm Beach to hold a Memorial Day service at Veterans Park on Monday, May 29th, 2023, from 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. Eight, requesting ratification of the emergency purchase of a van from Duval Ford in the amount of $75,896 by piggybacking the Florida Sheriff's Association Cooperative Purchasing Program. Funding source is from CIP Project PW22TR Truck Replacement. Nine, adoption of resolution number 2302, a resolution of the Village Council of the Village of Royal Palm Beach, Florida, providing for the approval and authorization for Senator Gail Harrell to utilize the official Village municipal seal as part of a display in her Tallahassee and district offices. Further providing that this use is for a proper civic purpose, providing an effective date and for other purposes. And 10, approval and authorization for the Village manager to enter into a professional services agreement for structural services with TRC Worldwide Engineering for 2 years.
Okay, thank you, Diana. Any members on council have any questions or comments?
I'd like to pull consent agenda item number two, please.
Number two?
Like to pull number four.
You want four?
Yes, please.
And you want two. Okay. So we got two and four. Okay, I look for a motion then on the remaining items on the consent agenda.
So I make a motion to approve consent agenda items 1, 3, 5 through 10.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? We have no opposed. Diane, please let the record show that consent agenda items were approved minus item 2 and 4. Who wants to go first? Two? Who's two? You?
It's just real quick. I understand the traffic control jurisdiction. I just wanted a clarification on the signals, because we had an incident where we had, I believe it was county roads, and residents wanted a controlled intersection or light put in. So does this now put the onus on us versus the county, or the county still responsible for traffic, for the lights?
Good question. I don't think so.
We are responsible for the traffic control devices on the county roads and the city roads in the village. On county roads, though, it has to meet their criteria, and it's got to be, it can only be put up in accordance with their criteria, which is the same criteria as ours.
Let me just say that a little differently. When you say we're responsible, that means the county has to approve it, but we pay for it.
Correct.
Okay?
Correct.
Okay, so in the instance where people do want a light put on their roadways, if it is in this area, meets the criteria of the county, the county's going to turn around and say the village needs to put it in because it meets the criteria that they have.
Yes, and we wouldn't have a problem doing that. Our own criteria is if a signal is warranted under the Uniform Manual Traffic Control Devices, right, then we'll install it.
We'll do it. Yeah.
Right. So And we have to pay for them on the county roads and our roads.
Yeah. Just wanted to clear, so it's out
that's
there.
That's the key. Okay.
Yep. I approve consent agenda item number 2.
Okay. Second. We have a motion. Well, do we?
You want to do both?
Let's do both, yeah.
All right.
Hold your motion on that. Okay. Okay.
So this is the time where we have our annual financial report, and I'd love to have a representative from Markham give us the highlights on the report.
Okay. I was wondering who's going to ask for that. Gentlemen, you have the floor.
Okay. Sorry about that.
Good.
Good afternoon, Honorable Mayor and Village Council. My name is Mo Reza. I'm with the firm of Markham, and I served as the audit partner for your September 30th, 2022 audit. And my colleague, Brandon Lopez, is one of our audit directors. And we're part of a team that performed the audit. It's just not ourselves, so we have a robust team that helped throughout the audit process. Before I get started on the presentation, I do, on behalf of the firm, we want to extend our condolences to the village staff, and the Hogman family on their loss. Even though we had just a brief time working with Stan, he was very helpful, and it was a pleasure working with him. If you recall, we started our contract for the first time with the village last year, and he was very helpful. When you transition with auditors, there's a lot of time and effort that goes into transitioning and bringing us up to speed. And with the help of Mr. Ned Lee, Stan was very gracious in assisting us throughout the process.
Thank you.
If you want, would like to follow along, I have, as part of today's agenda package, there should be a copy of the comprehensive the annual comprehensive financial report. I just want to highlight certain sections. So if you turn with me to printed page number 1. Printed page number 1 is our independent auditor's reports, and pretty much it summarizes the results of the audit. The first paragraph, titled Opinions, makes reference to what we audited. The first paragraph makes reference to the fiscal year end, September 30th, 2022. And the second paragraph is our opinions paragraph, which is the most important paragraph. And it mentions that the accompanying financial statements present fairly non-material respects the financial position of the village. In terms of a public accounting and an external financial report, this is an unmodified opinion. And this is the only opinion you want to be associated with. In regards to a financial audit, it's the highest regard that a village could receive. So congratulations to the village, the elected body, the village manager's office, and the finance department for receiving what is known as an unmodified or clean opinion. Following the auditor's report on page 4, if you turn with me to print page 4, this is the management discussion and analysis. This was put together by Mr. Stan and Chernette, and what this section of the document does, it compares prior year activity versus current year activity. The nice thing about this section is not only does it provide qualitative information, it provides justifications of what is causing the fluctuation to happen from current year to prior year. Following the MD&A, if you turn with me to printed page 11, you find the statement of net position. This is similar, but it's not the same to a balance sheet, what is known in the for-profit world. The reason it's not called a balance sheet because the statement itself doesn't balance. So that's why it nets out. You start off with your assets plus deferred outflows minus liabilities minus deferred inflows gets you to net position. Net position is just an accounting term for equity. If you look at your equity as of year end, you have unrestricted equity of north of 68 million, which is very, very strong compared to your peers. One of the requirements as the external auditor is we're supposed to compare you to your peers, not to rank you in who's number one and who's in last place, but to make sure that there's no unusual activity or fluctuation in your financial portfolio or your financial statements as compared to your peers. Who are your peers? Your peers are stipulated by the Florida Auditor General. The Florida Auditor General dictates who are your peers. They do that by determining the property tax value in your municipality, as well as the accounting funds. If you have enterprise funds as opposed to governmental funds, Do you have a utility system? Do you not have a utility system? So pleased to say that we did compare you to several of your peers, and we have nothing of concern to bring to your attention. Again, when it comes to liquidity and your net position, it's very strong. We're not at the liberty to rank you, but it's one of the top tier if you look at the projections. So again, very strong financial position for the village. After the financial statement and footnotes, there's several other reports. I wanted to highlight one specific report because it's not a common report that's issued for the village. And if you turn with me to printed page 98, that's all the way in the back of the report, but I wanted to highlight just because we believe it's important. On printed page 98, you'll find our uniform guidance report. And if you were to compare this document to several prior years, this is the first time that the village has received this report in some time now. And it's because there's a requirement that when you expend a certain amount of grant funds, either federal or state, there has to be something called a single audit. So where we go into the requirement of not only selecting what are your grants for this year, but doing a compliance testing. So when you think about a financial audit, you think about making sure that the amounts are complete and accurate. And there's a sense of what is no materiality, where something might be off for 25 cents, we will not report on that. When it comes to the uniform guidance, there's no sense of materiality. It's either yes or no. Either you're in compliance or you're not in compliance. When a federal agency gives you a grant or awards you a contract, you're required to adhere to certain requirements, from competitive bidding, to monitoring, to reporting, to several other compliance requirements. And as mentioned on page 98 through 100, pleased to mention we have no non-compliance items to report. If you turn with me to printed page 101, you'll notice the federal awards that were reported for the village of Royal Palm Beach for the fiscal year September 30th, 2022. That is the Highway Planning Construction Cluster, which was north of $900,000 in funding. That was used for park lights. If you remember, that was the program that we tested. Make sure you had competitive bidding. Make sure you have proper notice. Make sure all the requirements under the U.S. Department of Transportation were followed. And at the bottom, you received some funding from the U.S. Department of Justice. So again, our report, given the fact that it's a uniform guidance, this report this year gets submitted to what is known as the Data Collection Agency. And they're going to review that because the U.S. Department of Transportation will be waiting for our results. But again, nothing to report regarding non-compliance. Just wanted to highlight because it's not a common requirement for the village to have that single audit. Separate and apart from the document, we also issued our communication letter. And our communication letter is to highlight if we had any disagreements with management for accounting. Pleased to mention that we didn't have any disagreements regarding accounting or reporting a transaction or contract, and also make reference if we had any difficulties performing our audit. And pleased to mention that even though we had that extra layer of audit with a single audit, which is not common, it's more robust, we also had ARPA funding reporting requirements, and we also had new accounting pronouncements for leases. I'm not going to bore you with the accounting, but it was a very, very heavy or robust accounting year for the village. And pleased to mention that it got completed with ample time to meet the March 31st GFOA deadline. Again, I just want to thank the village manager, Ms. Chernette Lee, and Stan for helping us throughout the process.
Okay.
Open up for any questions you may have.
Any questions from members of council? No? All right. Well, thank you very much. We're glad that we've gone through the process, and I will say I'm not surprised with the outcomes, but you know, this we want to make sure it's we continue to stay on the right track, so to speak, and that's what we look forward to in this new fiscal year. So thank you again. We appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you. Okay. You want me to do a joint then? Huh? We have to do a joint. You want to do it?
Yeah, let's do a joint motion.
I make a motion to approve consent agenda items number 2 and 4.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? We have no opposed. Diane, please let the record show that agenda items 2 and 4 were approved 5-0. Okay, so that concludes our consent agenda. And we're going to start out with our regular agenda. Regular agenda item number 1 is a public hearing to consider variance application 22-128, an application by Investment Equity Group 3 to allow a parking variance from Village Code Section 23-51 sub 2Q to allow for 17 parking spaces, where the Village Code requires 42 parking spaces, a variance of 25 spaces, for a property located at 11710 Okeechobee Boulevard within the Village Center. This is a quasi-judicial item, but so are the next two.
Yes.
Or for the same applicant, so you want to do them all three?
That was what I was going to ask you.
We will swear for all three, but we will vote individually for each item.
Right, this will be
doing webcam.
Okay.
So, agenda items 1, 2, and 3 are all quasi-judicial proceedings, which means your testimony to the Village Council needs to be sworn, so I need to place you under oath. If you're going to be testifying or speaking to the Village Council on any of the agenda items 1, 2, or 3, please stand and raise your right hands, and I will swear everybody in together. Bradford, you too. Thank you. Do each of you swear or affirm under penalties of perjury that your testimony to the Village Council tonight will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Thank you. You can all have a seat, and I need to come back to council on all three of these. Same property, same applicant, but if there have been any ex parte discussions, site visits, consultations with experts, whatever it may be, those would need to be disclosed for the record at this time for any of those three agenda items.
So, had discussions with the applicant?
I met with the village manager.
Staff.
Manager.
Okay, then we've had our disclosures, and where everybody is sworn in, Mayor, so we can proceed with
okay.
these items.
Great, thank you, sir. The applicant is requesting a parking variance from Village Code of Ordinances, Section 23-51-2Q, to allow for 17 parking spaces where Village Code requires 42 parking spaces, a variance of 25 parking spaces. That section of the code requires a minimum of one space per 75 square feet of gross floor area plus one space per employee on maximum work shift. The variance request is being made in conjunction with a site plan modification, special exception, landscape waiver, and architectural approval request in order to allow for the development of a Starbucks within the Village Center located at southwest corner of Okeechobee Boulevard and Royal Palm Beach Boulevard. It is important to note on March 19th, 2020, Village Council approved a variance order BC 20-02 in order to reduce the number of required parking spaces from the required 149 parking spaces to 143 parking spaces, resulting in a variance of 6 parking spaces for the existing office building. Combined with the previously approved parking variance and current request would result in a parking deficit of 31 parking spaces of the Village Code required 175 parking spaces. Village Code Section 2632F6 allows the Village Council to grant variances when special conditions and circumstances exist which are peculiar to the land structure or building involved. Not result from the actions of the applicant, will not confer on the applicant any special privilege. A literal interpretation of the provisions of this vision would deprive the applicant rights commonly enjoyed by other properties. That the variance granted is a minimum variance that will make possible the reasonable use of the land, will be in harmony with the general intent and purpose of this division, but will not be injurious to the area involved, detrimental to the public welfare. The applicant contends that the parking variance request is specific to the proposed parcel, only it has no impact on the medical office building on parcel 1 or the future bank site on parcel 2, even though all parking is shared across all uses within the Village Center PCD, and the opportunity to share parking across property creates a unique circumstance. The uses developed and proposed within the Village Center are complementary in that they have alternate peak demand times that allow for the most efficient use of the parking spaces provided on site. Additionally, Urban Land Institute provides data for sharing parking conditions similar to this site. Information from the ULI has been utilized to explain the relationships of the total site parking demand and peak times, which justifies the parking reduction request. Based on the information provided, village staff does not support the variance request as granted of the variance would confer special privileges denied to other properties in similar circumstances. No special conditions and circumstances are applicable to the subject property. The request is needed due to actions of the applicant as it relates to the proposed restaurant and drive-through and will be injurious to the area involved. And therefore, is requesting a recommend or requesting denial of this application. The Planning and Zoning Commission considered this application on February 28, 2023 and recommended approval by a vote of 4-0 with the condition that the applicant work with staff to reduce the requested parking variance by eliminating the outdoor seating area, dumpster, and landscape areas. And with that being said, Mayor, I'll turn the floor back over to you. Thank you.
Just so we're clear on this. So the Planning and Zoning Commission approved it with conditions.
With the condition that the applicant work with village staff to reduce the request by considering the elimination of the outdoor seating area,
okay,
elimination of one of the dumpsters, and maybe some reconfiguring of the landscape
islands. You can't give up a dumpster. No.
Well, they've got two of them.
I'm saying, okay, we got two. But in also the, so if they eliminated the, I just want to make sure we got the facts kind of clear. If they eliminated the outdoor seating, how many spaces does that buy back?
Four.
Only four?
Right.
Okay. All right. You were saying that there's a total of 175 parking spaces in that entire development there?
That's what the code is requiring.
And of the 175, we're already down? We would be down 31 or we're down 31 now?
You would be down 31 from
that. We would be down 31.
Correct.
Okay. All right.
The Starbucks requires one space for every 75 square feet plus employees. The total site is down 31 sites. The medical office got a variance for parking. So
we did give them a variance.
If this was approved, plus the ones that are already approved, there'd be a deficit from our code of 31 spots.
So that's what
with it. And, but they'd be providing 143 on the total site.
Okay. All right. Before we give the applicant this. Points of clarification from Bradford. Anybody need anything cleared?
If you can go back to the map or the overhead. And that one. All right, with your cursor, where are you looking to remove the parking spaces? Well, that one's even better.
Yeah. Now, when you say remove the parking spaces.
So
this is the site that they're proposing.
Okay.
So they're required a certain number of parking spaces, and they're asking for a reduction in that requirement by 25, which is over half what is required by
right. So where are they they're taking the two dumpsters there. They have the outdoor seating.
It would be, I would contend that you could get probably two parking spaces in here.
Okay.
And then you would remove the outdoor seating, and then that outdoor seating reduces your required number of parking spaces.
Okay. So I think my concern is every Starbucks I've ever been in, when you look at the people that are in there, they're not in and out. The majority of them, they're going through the drive-through. Otherwise, they're there all day. And then with the outdoor seating, you're encouraging them to stay. And then when you have staff, so this is my concern is when you start taking the spaces away, your staff needs to park. You're inviting people to stay and enjoy the outdoor space. And then I understand if you need the two dumpsters just based on the sheer volume of what you do.
Let's get comments.
Yeah, so that's,
I want to give the applicant a chance to make their presentation.
But those are my questions, though, because if those are the things that Planning and Zoning did with their requests, that's right.
Yeah, okay.
That's why I wanted to clarify that.
All right, let's give the applicant an opportunity to make their comments.
Good evening, Brian Terry with Insight Studio. Pleasure to be here this evening, Mayor, Council. It's good to see everybody. It's been a little while since I've had the pleasure of being in front of everybody here. I need to accept this, is that right? I need to accept.
Yes.
So I will try to give a kind of an overview here of the proposal in total. And then obviously, you know, there are three different items. Obviously, the variance is the one that needs to be addressed first. And so I'll try to go through, give you a broad perspective of everything that's being proposed on the property, and then we can get to those. I'm trying to get to share the full screen.
Just do slideshow.
There we go. All right. Again, Bradford has given you an overall. Obviously, you guys are very familiar with the property being right across the street. And so I won't belabor that too much. Again, what we're talking to specifically is what's identified as parcel three within that overall master plan. It's broken into three parcels, but it's really one plan development. Again, hence the cross-parking, cross-access that goes over the entire property. So here's how the plan exists or is approved as of today. You can see, again, this is approved as a bank parcel. On parcel three, had a drive-through working around the backside of the property, the medical office building, and then the unbuilt bank that's down on the south end of this property as well. So again, we have the three applications, the site plan, the parking variance. We do have a couple of landscape waivers that we're requesting, and we can touch on those a bit later. Obviously, the primary conversation needs to be centered around the variance itself. So these are, again, photos, which I know you guys are very familiar with the property. It's a parking lot that's really only being utilized at this point in time by the medical office. This council did approve a small variance to that medical office use when it was converting, if you recall, from having partial professional office internal to that building to converting to full medical office. And so by doing that, there was a requirement of some additional parking, and this council worked to accommodate for the variance on that piece. So you can see how this plan is being proposed in total with the overall development, with the restaurant being located where that bank is. You can see how the drive-through circulation works on this plan, the access from Okeechobee, you know, and the circulation around the building itself. Really, this side of the parking lot is not modified from how it's approved today. Slight modifications, again, accommodation of some dumpsters that are located here where the crosswalk is. And then what was on the approved plan at the bank, there was no parking on this site, so we flipped and moved some of the parking to accommodate for the configuration of the Starbucks plan.
Real quick, it's one drive-through, correct, not two?
It's one drive-through with a bypass lane that extends around it. So, again, kind of zooming in a little bit so you can understand the site as a whole. There is a cross-access point to which is the Denny's that goes out to Civic Center to the west. You have, again, the building, which is just over 2,200 square feet with the outdoor dining, sidewalk connections, the parking that circulates really on both the north, the west, and the east sides. And so, when we started looking at this as an opportunity, certainly we knew the challenge coming into this was going to be centered around the parking and quite frankly, the stacking as well. That's always the two major concerns that we need to face. I will show you quickly the architecture of the building. As you can see, it's quite simple. And yes.
Can you go back to that last? I just got a question. You mentioned it already. You said the stacking word.
I'm going to get to it.
You go, oh, right,
yeah,
okay.
I've got a slide in here. We'll definitely cover it. Let's have a conversation about it. Again, just kind of putting the architecture so everybody can see, which is a very typical and simplified architectural plan that I think works good in context with the bank building. I'm sorry, the medical office building that's on the property as well. So talking to the parking, again, there is a history here. One of the things that is quite frankly unique and about Royal Palm Beach and your code is the requirement of 1 per 75 square feet for a drive-through restaurant. That is unique in the sense that it's different than most every other municipality. And so that's creating an expectation or requirement of 42 parking spaces for use that quite frankly won't ever utilize those 42 parking spaces. Brian with Simmons and White is gonna come up and speak. He's our traffic engineer, did extensive parking studies that he's gonna kind of walk you through to really understand that utilization across the other uses on the property and the real expectation and demand for those. Before I pull you up, I do wanna kind of say, you had asked like what parking spaces are gonna go away. But what I'd like to kind of show you is sort of how the parking spaces are sort of divvied up. Again, any one user can use any parking space on the property, There's none that are specific to a building. But as you can see, just generally how we expect this to break out, would if that variance were to be approved and then as planned we're moving forward, 17 spaces that are associated with the Starbucks are kind of identified in green. The requirement for the medical office and what was mentioned in the staff report is saying we're not impacting the other users in the sense that we're accommodating and making sure that, you know, our variance isn't with withdrawing the ability for or reducing the parking spaces that are being made available and utilized by the other users. So you can see those 110 for the medical office, and then the yellow is the approved bank that's unbuilt, of course, and the 17 spaces that would be utilized for that use.
Go back on that drawing. Where's Denny's?
Denny's is just off the page here, just
to the left
in the hatch, correct. And so they're not a part of this development. They weren't approved as a part of this planned development. They're a separate standalone approval.
You can get in and out past through there, right?
Yes, it does have cross access agreement. We were the original developers of this area, and we put all that in place when we did the development and sold it to Denny's. So that condition is always that cross access
has always
been there, and and for the use of this property and the Denny's property for that matter.
Okay.
And my last talking point before the other Brian gets to speak is I just wanted to bring this up because I think it's important just to understand in context. Again, this type of use, this scale of use, this intensity of use is very common, not just in this locality, but I just wanted to put up some of the municipalities that are about around you and what those requirements would be for this exact same use in those municipalities. These are their code requirements for parking based on this intensity. So again, in every municipality, Palm Beach County, Wellington, Loxahatchee Groves, City West Palm Beach, we would be basically right on the mark of what the expectation code minimum criteria would be for parking based on our square footage or number of the seats, right? They calculate it as based on number of seats, whereas you guys do it on square footage, and that's where the disconnect occurs.
With that real quick then, how many seats are you gonna have?
So we have approximately 50. And so it's 17, I think that comes out to 51. But we do have another parking space. We think we can bump that up at least by one. Maybe not on the dumpster. There was a suggestion that was made at PZV, but we have it. I'll show you that in a minute. So again, if you were to do that in comparison, it'd be approximately 54. And that's including indoor and outdoor.
And Mayor, the way our code is written is if it's a standalone restaurant, it requires the one for 75 plus the employees. If it's an out parcel, like Panera Bread or any of those, it's 1 to 200, and because it's able to use the extreme the parking lots the parking spaces furthest away from retail. In this case, we're using the 1 to 75 as this is a standalone, even though it does have the parking near it, but it was done separately. If it was 1 to 200, the 17 would meet the code.
It would work, yeah. Okay.
Looks like it's my turn now. For the record, Brian Kelly, I'm a professional traffic engineer with Simmons & White. So our office prepared the parking study. We did a shared parking study for this project. And want to go over a couple of things that we did with it, the methodology and the rates that we utilized. So as was just mentioned, the village code is the 1 per 75 square feet based on a restaurant with drive-through. Well, we looked at what's called the Institute of Transportation Engineers. You may have heard that before, the ITE. They have a parking generation manual. So this is a industry standard manual that's utilized all throughout South Florida, really all throughout the United States, by engineers and planners and professionals. And the rates that are utilized within there are based on numerous studies and data collection points that are done, for pretty much any kind of land use. So they actually, within the IT, actually have a specific land use for coffee shop with drive-through. So we looked at that rate, and that rate, roughly, kind of for square footage purposes, equates to during the weekday, because they have weekday and they also have weekend. The weekday equated to one parking space per 192 square feet, and the weekend was one parking space per 115 square feet.
And you're basing that on actual utilization rates?
So this is based on the Institute of Transportation Engineers. They have a actual data collection.
They models.
It's done on, I don't want to call it a model necessarily, it's done on data collection at a whole bunch of coffee shops, and they look at the rate on what that max parking is for all those different locations. So it's it's certainly far different than a TPA model or something like that. So what that equates to, so for the coffee shop that we're talking about, 2,500 square feet, that's 13 spaces during the weekend and 22 during the weekend. So weekdays a little bit less, weekends a little bit higher. I may have I said that correctly. So that's part one. So we looked at the ITE rates for the coffee shop, but we also have to consider the Village Center has the medical office and will have a bank in the future, and we need a plan for that. So we looked at what's called the Urban Land Institute, the ULI. They have a shared parking guidebook, and what this is based on is different peak utilizations throughout the day. Obviously, a restaurant is going to have a higher or different utilization than you know, an office maybe, which is busier during the day, and a restaurant's going to be busier at night, so to speak. So those are the examples there. So the coffee shop tends to have a little bit different than a medical office and bank. The coffee shop, particularly during the week, is going to be a little bit busier in the early morning, more 7:30. People are coming in, getting coffee on their way to work, where banks and medical offices or tend to be a little bit later, so 9, 10 a.m. and then maybe early afternoon, where the coffee shop's certainly less busy. There's some other differences too. So besides the time of day differences, and not to mention during the weekend when a coffee shop, a Starbucks, will be busier, and certainly that's when people will be parking there, maybe staying longer throughout the day on a Saturday when there's more time. You know, a bank and a medical office is certainly going to be very low occupancy. They may have a few hours, but there's it's not going to be fully occupied. Those. So coffee shops, they probably have a little bit more drive-through business than dine-in compared to a typical fast food. And, you know, I would argue they do have shorter stays than typical fast food restaurants. I do acknowledge there will be certain people that go and stay there for a while. I think Saturdays, it's probably a little bit more commonplace. But just from my, you know, certainly my own experiences of going in there, getting coffee and just leaving, you know, I like to think I have kids and I've gone to, I can't tell you how many times the McDonald's trip was supposed to be quick. And then we get food, eat, and then we're there 45 minutes while the kids are on the playground. So there are some inherent differences between getting coffee, a quick drink, and leaving, and then versus sitting down, eating, and maybe there's a playground and other things. So there's certainly some difference there. So kind of taking all of this into consideration, we look at the ITE parking rates for the different uses, and we also look at the shared parking rates as well, and we combine those uses. We actually have a significant surplus of parking for the whole Village Center. So the numbers on the bottom there are what they are. So the proposed parking is at 144 spaces, and during the weekday, the maximum that we would be anticipating is only 95 spaces being utilized, and then on the weekend, obviously, it's way, way lower because it's really, the Starbucks is half of that at 42. So the surplus during the week would be 49 spaces, and on the weekend would be 102. And frankly, that's really considered the worst case scenario. At various other times throughout the day, it would be less than that. I just kind of summarized that. This is kind of the table, but I won't get into all the details. The bottom line is the numbers I just gave you. That's really the important part of this. And this is just a quick statement, really reiterating what I just said. You know, we expect a parking surplus of 49 spaces for the Village Center during peak utilization, and even really a greater amount during the majority of days and times. So do you want me to go ahead and get into queuing? Okay, so queuing. We understand there is a concern for queuing.
Do we want to do queuing now?
Or do you want to go questions?
Well, the way this is set up in the agenda is you got a parking variance. If that's approved, you can move forward. If you can't, it really kind of dies. Then you got the landscape waivers, which are the second agenda. And then if those two are approved, then we talk about the site and talk about the queuing, because it is completely different from the other two. And the queuing meets our code, but we do have some special conditions of approval in there because of the success of Starbucks and the fear of the desire to keep Okeechobee from being backed up. So, and they've agreed to those, and I think that should be done with the site plan.
All right, so that's item the third.
That's the third
three.
Item.
Okay, yes. All right, we can wait to item three. Go ahead.
Can I just add I don't want to confuse the parking.
No,
I think you made a really good parking presentation.
No,
he showed the numbers.
That makes sense. Good. Yeah.
Right. Ray, is there not, though, a link between the parking spaces and those conditions?
No. not the conditions. There's a link between the queuing and the drive through and the condition.
Okay, that's parking. That's what I meant. So if, and I'll wait until we get to the queuing part. But there seems to be the notion about having adequate and maybe even surplus parking. Should it turn out that the queuing becomes a problem, and an extreme condition takes place, which is shutting down the drive-through, at that point in time, those surplus spaces will become used because there isn't any other way to access Starbucks. I mean, I thought there was that kind of a fail-safe notion in kind of arguing for more parking spaces than might otherwise be the case if queuing wasn't that big a concern.
And in their parking presentation, they showed you that there is a surplus to handle that too.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
Okay. So we'll hold off the queuing until the third agenda item.
Yep.
I just want to, okay. So we have a comment card. I'm going to ask the,
if you don't mind, I want to show you one more thing that's related to the parking before we move to the public comment. And certainly if you have any questions of Mr. Kelly, I'm sure he could answer them as well related to his report. As was mentioned, and again, the idea was brought up at PZB that we work with staff. I apologize, we didn't actually work directly with staff on working through potential opportunities here. But I did want to show you one thing that we do believe is possible. We went back and really kind of studied the survey. There is an expanded large island in this location. That we believe we can fit one more parking space in here that would get us to a total of 18. Again, trying to minimize that ask, minimize that variance as much as we possibly can to make it the minimum. And this would still keep 10 parking spaces in a row, which, correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe that's allowed for 10 in a row, which would still be located in this position. The suggestion was made at planning and zoning that we consider removing a dumpster to accommodate for some additional parking. Starbucks is very conscious about their footprint, and one of those is obviously for trash. The other one is anticipated to be their recycling. Wanted to make, you know, that is a requirement and expectation of them that they have two dumpsters on the property, so that really isn't an option for us to agree to. So that is really the one thing I just wanted to bring to your attention of the addition that we're proposing here. Obviously, something that we need to.
I knew up front the environmental issues would say we need the two dumpsters, but it's okay.
Real quick, though, I know it's pertained to a second part, but because of a visual and I want to look at options for the outdoor seating, can you go to the slide once ahead that does have the stacking? Because I want to see the way you have your traffic pattern.
It's part of the stacking discussion.
I understand that, but I have a question because if P&Z is saying that they want them to remove the outdoor seating, I want to see how you see the traffic flow coming through. Okay, that's what I wanted to see. Thanks.
And to be frank, because we are talking, again, I guess the outdoor seating.
I just wanted to see that.
The outdoor seating is another thing I should address. It was also brought up as a potential way to minimize or reduce the variance request. Post-COVID, it is certainly almost a requirement, and I think it's something that we all really look for opportunities to have outdoor seating areas. We think that would be detrimental to the project and the business as a whole. And for the patrons to eliminate the outdoor seating.
And that's why I wanted to see how you had the traffic flow coming through, because if that, it doesn't make sense to have it anywhere else, and that's what I wanted to see. Thank you.
Okay. I guess I just want to make sure on this parking and issue is it's driven because of our ordinance, our code saying what the multiplier is. It's not because the footprint of the building is too big or something along that line. It's not like we're shoehorning, but it's the aggregate. When you don't look at the aggregate of all the parking spaces available in the plot, right? We're looking at the parking spaces most closely adjacent to this restaurant. Is that an accurate way to state that? I'm trying to get the right context as to why are we asking for this variance, okay? That's really...
Well...
Aha, you too. You and Jan, okay.
It's my magnetic personality.
We'll go with that reference.
I'm trying to understand the question.
I know. It's why are we here? Because they our ordinance says they need
we treated
25.
It as a standalone restaurant.
Yeah,
required
we treated it as a standalone.
Spot
so therefore, the number's higher.
Instead of an out parcel type
That's
parcel,
the point.
That would be part of a larger shopping center. That,
yeah.
Yes, our code allows for the 1 to 200 within a shopping center. This
okay.
is clearly.
I think it's important for us to put that in context. All right.
We did not consider this a shopping center, so we looked at standalone. But the uniqueness of this is it is associated with, it's not completely standalone.
But because of right. your genius of us doing it, having passed through where everything makes that a reality in sense. So, okay. That was the point I wanted to make. We have a gentleman here who, Mr. Roger Livingston, comment card on agenda. I guess you want to comment, period, right?
Yes.
Please.
My name is Roger Livingston. 9704 Westlake Court in Royal Palm. I am the owner of the Denny's right next door. And I'm the closest. I mean, I understand, you know, the whole that group, that parking area, but I am the closest to this Starbucks. And I have cross access right there and parking within a few feet of that Starbucks.
Mm-hmm.
That is going to be severely impacted by this. It's not, and it's not just there's a lot of traffic and a lot of people using parking spaces. There's DoorDash and Uber. They get a lot of delivery drivers too that are using parking spaces that are going to use my parking lot because it's the closest. The entrance is on the north facing side. It's the closest to my parking area. The other parking is cut off by the drive-thru, so it's going to be a natural thing for them to park in that area and to exit that area back to through my parking lot to get back on Okeechobee. There's no real good way to get back on Okeechobee except through Civic Center way, and that means that I'm going to be not only backed up because you look at the way this drive-thru is set up. They have it queued up going around out to Okeechobee. There's nothing that prevents it from being queued up coming through my parking lot and entering right through there. So having a zipper effect going on that's backing and knocking out my parking spaces because cars are queued up in my parking lot and cars are queued up at that stop sign to get back on Civic Center Way to get back on Okeechobee. Because there's no other way to get back on Okeechobee. If you want to try to get through Royal Palm Boulevard, that's fine, but that's a busy, without a light intersection.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm looking at what I, and I feel like people are going to cut through on the backside. If there's cars backed up at the stop sign to get on Civic Center Way behind, they're going to cut through my parking lot to get to that stop sign to cut the line. So I feel like with the amount of traffic, drive-through, and DoorDash and Uber people picking up to goes. I'm just going to be one long drive-through line, and nobody's going to be able to get in and out. Oh, and it's going to be a safety hazard because I got families coming in and kids running across my parking lot too. So I'm looking at a real nightmare here, as far as the usage. The whole shopping center, the medical center. I don't think it's going to be used very much at all. It's going to go west, and it's going to be my north-facing area and their little bit of their area facing Okeechobee is what's going to try to be used for the Starbucks, and that's just going to cut down a lot of my parking.
Do you have any suggestions on how we could cure these issues that you've raised?
Listen, Starbucks is an incredibly successful. They are going to, and they are operating at the same time when we're busy. So it's not like it's a mismatch of time where when we're dead, they're busy or vice versa. We're going to be competing for parking spaces at the same time. So I don't know. I know we had the cross access and at the last meeting they said they can't do anything about that. I don't know how to get people back on Okeechobee without going through my
parking. When you said they can't do anything about that, what's that?
They were talking about blocking. It was mentioned to block it off, but they can't block it off. The access point
the
to keep everything.
Yeah.
So
you mean close the cross access?
Is yes. That's what they were talking about. They can't do that. And if they can't do that, then I am one long line.
Then this is why this queuing the conversation is going to be interesting, because that's really the point that we really need to pay attention to, I believe. All right. Sounds like you're saying you don't want to see a Starbucks there.
I don't know how to do it and keep my parking lot safe.
Okay.
And having the ability to use it. I don't know.
I think your points are very cogent, and I appreciate you coming in to share that with us. I think the challenge before us is to come up with a design solution that will address these issues that he's raising, particularly the safety issue, because you do have, you know, folks with kids. So with that as a backdrop, before we go forward, do we have any, Diane, any prior comments from the public? No. Ray, anyone's got your hand raised?
No, Mayor.
Okay. Do you have anything else you want to add? No, I'm just asking you. I'll leave it open for you. Right, if you think there's something you still want to add, because we have two more items. Okay, that work?
I'd like to ask a question.
I'm going
to
open
if
it
you
up
don't,
now.
Okay,
you go first. Go ahead.
We won't talk about the queuing because that's further. Because it seems to me, and let me make sure I'm getting it right. The two big concerns of yours are number one, as you said, the parking spaces, they're going to, you know, DoorDash and you get busy at the same time. Everyone's going to fill up your parking spaces over by your restaurant as opposed to the ones here because there's so much less. Now, if they had more parking places, is there a number of parking places? If in your mind the parking places complied with the code, that issue would be off the table? Or am I hearing that right? Because that's how I'm interpreting what you're saying. They need the parking spaces that they need under the code to make it work for me, meaning you.
Well, I don't think that.
Just on the parking issue, because
on the parking
not
issue,
queuing.
I just, when I look at it realistically, the way it's designed, my parking is going to be the premium spaces for Starbucks.
Right, assuming that they get a variance and they don't have to build the ones that are required under code. But what I'm trying to get at is if they comply with the code, you basically don't have a beef, right? If they have all of the what's required, I'm trying to explain how you could have a beef if this is what they're legally required to do and they do it.
Right.
My only issue,
I mean, I get that if you have a certain number of parking spaces that are usable for that, that's fine. Mm-hmm. I just don't. To be honest with you, I just don't think their clientele is going to use those parking spaces. They're going to use mine on Okeechobee because it's closer.
Okay.
See, and I look at it more as that I believe, because I frequent your Denny's, is that it's going to be the access coming through more than the parking. Because
well,
you do have the median there, and I don't think people, I honestly don't think people are going to park on the Denny's side in order to come over to Starbucks, but I do agree that it's the cross access is the problem.
I think
primarily.
You're right, because I've gone there too, and I would.
Yeah, I wouldn't cross.
I wouldn't
walk over.
Yeah,
That and just the queuing to get out onto Civic Center Way to get back to Okeechobee. I don't know how the flow is going to go when they're leaving when the DoorDashers are leaving and when the drive-through is leaving. How do they flow out?
Well, that's what I wanted to see the stacking.
Why don't we put the DoorDashers over there at the other end? I mean,
I don't know.
Well, because they want to be as close to the front as possible because they're in and out.
Well,
they even have them stacked up ready for them.
It's one of the things that grew out of this COVID thing we've been living in.
And
okay?
and that's, I mean, could be 20-30% of the business.
For you or for them?
I think for all.
Okay, for you. But let me ask you a question. You got spaces allocated out there for the pickup guys?
We have curbside pickup spaces,
Did you get that approved? You can't just do that, you know.
I did not get it approved.
But then it's illegal what you did.
Mr.
All right, just letting you know. No, the point I'm making is this. What we could do is put legal DoorDash parking spaces instead of right up front, right there, away from it, which means I'm sorry, the DoorDash people, and they would have to walk a little bit to get their pickup. But instead of just being right there in the front door.
We just have a curbside for regular customers.
Yeah, but let's get beyond COVID, okay? I mean, let's get some reality back in place here. Okay.
Free market capitalism.
All right.
I do have questions.
Other questions, go ahead.
And these are actually, I think, all for Bradford. And I apologize, I did not prepare you ahead of time. So we have two other Starbucks in the village. And
we do?
We yep. do. And Mr. Kelly, I don't know which Starbucks you go to.
Where's the other one?
There's one on
State Road 7 and Southern.
Hobby yeah, Lobby. The one right in front of Costco. And the other one is on State Road 7
but
in front of
Hobby
Lobby.
That's way out, like, at the borderline. Oh, yeah, that's like,
okay. We have two Starbucks in the village.
I think that's the borderline. Is that Wellington? Anyway,
no,
go ahead.
No.
Costco?
Neither one.
In front
it's
of Costco?
Not Southern Boulevard.
It's ours.
No, not Costco.
No,
the one down
on State Road 7 by Hobby Lobby.
It's North
Southern.
The one right before, right by Belvedere.
Oh, I didn't realize that. Yeah, I wish I'd never go to that one.
No, I was going to say, so it is. They both have drive. No, just that one. The other one doesn't. That one does. So, Mr. Kelly, I don't know which Starbucks you go to, but it's primarily busy during the day because that's where all the free Wi-Fi users go all day. So they're going to park, they're going to stay. They're not driving through with the roundabout, the drive-through. But because the other two Starbucks are very different in size and the locations are. So I kind of antiquate this one to the one on State Road 7, but it almost looks like that they're trying to use the same parking logic as we have in Southern Crossings.
Right.
So were accommodations made for those? Did they ask for, do you know that?
Those were located in a bona fide shopping center. So it used the 1 to 200 grade. And those two, the existing ones, don't have the drive through, but the one at the Costco does have the drive through, and they had the 1 to 200 grade.
No, so Costco doesn't have the drive through.
No.
The other
they're building one.
Oh, the new one does. That's right, because they moved into the bank building, right?
Is it finished?
No.
Okay. Yeah.
So So then that is going to increase that side of it then, and the traffic flow. I'm trying to think like how to compare this. I mean, I'll look at it. I don't know how you would put those other. If you take out the outdoor seating and you take out that one garbage dumpster, I don't think those parking spaces are really going to make that much of a difference. I do personally think the outdoor seating is beneficial. That's why I wanted to see the stacking so I can see as well. Do you put it there or do you put it somewhere else? But you really can't based on how you have the traffic flow, and that's why I was looking for that. I don't, Mr. Livingston, I can understand your concern. I think the next issue is going to be the drive-through more than the parking. I think people are going to end up parking closer to the medical building because they're not using their parking right there. So although anyone here will tell you I hate variances, but I can see where you may not need as many parking spaces. And if your staff, we did this with the chicken place that's moving in on Southern and State Road 7, is we just had where staff had to park, further away.
Exactly. Yeah.
And make that designated instead of having them take up the parking spaces closest to the building and the moving over. So
that can be managed. That's,
right. And I think that'll help with the parking situation so staff's not taking that up and that they're required to park further away. So those are my thoughts on this.
Yeah. All right, we're supposed to vote on these items independently, 1, 2, and 3. Before we progress, we need to make a decision on the parking variance.
Once again, staff's only concern, the only reason for the denial was because it's against our code, correct?
It's technical.
Yeah.
It's technical, that's what I mean. It's because it is, it's asking for variance based on our code. Got it.
Anyway, okay. So, because of the configuration, how it's set up, it's not designated as a shopping center.
And I think that maybe to speak to the portion of your question that you had, I think that there is the idea of scale, like where you have a Costco shopping center with a 1 to 200, we're talking thousands of parking spaces. The same with the shopping center that off of State Road 7. You're talking 300, 400, 500 parking spaces. Here you have a smaller pool of those parking spaces where the 1 to 75 can be absorbed into what is there.
Okay, just some thoughts. My experience has been going into this area here that there's a whole sector of parking spaces that are just not used. There's a clear underutilization. Just like water, it seeks the closest space to the building. That's where people try to park. I'm hope there's some options or things that we can look at to create a better disbursement and utilization of the available parking spaces. I think we're going to have to look at the ingress egress issue, particularly on Okeechobee Boulevard, and we might have to come up with some solutions there. Maybe we have another driveway at the other end or something. I don't know. I think we need to, when we get to that, looking at that, those are things we should be open to consider. I will also remind us that I don't know, was it 2 years ago, Ray, a year and a half ago, when we modified conditions for this location to accommodate a drive-through?
It was January of 2022, so just over a year ago.
Okay. And I was in full disclosure, at that meeting, I said, you know, if we're considering the possibility of having a Starbucks at this location, I supported the request because that's something that I thought would be a good thing for the village and the citizens. So just putting that in context, we kind of laid groundwork for this. At the time, there was no discussion about, you know, parking spaces and ordinances and that sort of thing, obviously. So now we're here, and they're at the front door, and we're looking at potential project to have that happen. I think some of the points raised and concerns are real, and I think we just need to figure out what we can do to try to mitigate those issues, those concerns, and make a greater utilization of the parking that is available. Right.
Go ahead. One more thing, and maybe one of you guys can answer this. The restaurant that's going there, is it one of the Starbucks where it is full service of everything, or is it limited to the baked goods? Because that, I think, is also going to determine how long people hang around.
I can't answer that question 100%.
So you're not sure then?
No, with no degree of certainty,
I didn't know there was
to be able to say that. I can say for sure it's not coffee only. That I'm sure of.
Sorry.
My name is Ashley Rumble with Investment Equity Group.
Thanks. So you're not sure then? I mean, then you haven't even purchased your equipment then, so you don't even know what you're in there for.
I'm the developer. Starbucks is actually the operator.
Right.
So,
yeah. But that's what I'm saying. But he doesn't know which that they're going to use it for, so that's why I'm asking. Okay.
Again, I'm positive it's not coffee only, so how limited their menu is inside that I'm not sure. I will say this is the smallest footprint that they have, and that does affect
the
sales.
Sale with the sales. Gotcha.
This one, it reminds me of the one on the east side of Okeechobee, right by 95.
Yes,
that one's really tiny.
Yes, it's really tiny, and I love, because that's my firsthand experience as far as the stacking question.
So tiny,
up.
I don't even know it's there.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh no, it's terrible. And then I have to park sometimes in the daycare to run in there because the line is backed up on Okeechobee. But that's for our next agenda item.
You want to say
just to remind the council, when we did the amendment to allow the coffee shop, we also included a definition of coffee shop for this purpose. And it's relevant to your question. A coffee shop is a small, informal establishment. Primary business is the retail sale of brewed coffee for immediate consumption, which may serve light meals and refreshments, but having no table service or full course meals offered to patrons.
Okay. So it is not the one, the full one
standard.
That you get all year. Okay.
Yeah. Still get egg bites.
That's what I'm asking.
Just saying.
Okay.
So, maybe I missed the answer to this question already, but so in the worst case scenario for you all, if we were to deny the variance request, impact, next step?
Would that be the worst case?
I think that obviously, right. I mean, the reality is the site is confined to a point where the number of parking spaces is likely not going to change what can be accommodated on this property. Your answer is it would most likely in the conversation associated with the ability to utilize this for any type of a drive-through, whether it be coffee or any type of use similar to that. So, I think that Again, I know we have larger other items and issues that we need to talk through, which I think we do have some suggestions and some ideas on what we can bring forward to maybe alleviate some of those concerns. But yeah, without the parking variance, there's really not, there's nowhere to move forward for us.
Anything else?
No, that's pretty important to know, I think. And so the one thing, yes, one thing beyond that. So if it were to be denied, it sounds like one of the next steps or possibilities here would be to eliminate the drive-through.
Well,
why would that? Yeah, I'm not getting.
Well, to get the additional space.
No,
that's not.
Wouldn't give it enough.
It wouldn't be something. I mean, Starbucks would no longer have interest in the property if that were the case.
That's what we went through the trouble.
Right.
I hear you.
Okay, you're just trying to figure out.
From my experience, Jeff, the closest Starbucks to my house is the one that's in the Costco Plaza, and it's really nice, and it's everything like that, but it's in a strip mall building, and that's not their successful model, apparently, which is why we approved them with that bank thing that was there so that they can do a thing. Correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems like that's the business model. A standalone Starbucks where you just park and go in isn't their model, or at least not the most models I've seen.
Right. I think not just Starbucks, but most of users similar to that, a large majority or a good more than 50% generally of their sales comes through their drive-thru.
Right. But there are Starbucks out there that were like that. In fact, the one over on Forest Hill Boulevard used to be like that.
Right.
And they put it in the drive-thru, and it brought all kinds of interesting experiences as a result of that. It's still alive. It was alive up to the point in time when they put it in the drive-thru. It was operating for many, many years. So I get it. It's desirable. It really is desirable. I understand that. It makes sense. It's just a matter of trying to figure out how to make this make sense for everybody that's going to be impacted by it, as well as served by it.
Right, sure. And again, I think some of the concerns that you're sharing are things that, again, we need to, that are site-specific design and operational, that are related to how the site functions and works on a day-to-day basis, that I think we can continue that conversation.
Any other comments, questions? All right, we still got more items to go over, so for this particular item, agenda item number R1, I look for a motion.
I make a motion to approve regular agenda item number 1.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Nay.
Nay. One opposed? Two opposed? Diane, please let show that the agenda item R1 was approved on a 3-2 vote. Okay. I don't like variances. It's very good.
I know,
but this is, okay. Okay, let's move on then. Agenda item R2 is a public hearing to consider application 22-164, an application by Investment Equity Group 3 for the consolidation of landscape waiver for the Village Code Section 15-133 sub D sub 2 to allow for a reduced landscape island width of 5 feet north of the dumpster and 3 feet on the southwest corner of the site where Village Code requires 8 feet. Waivers of 3 feet and 5 feet respectively for a property located at 11710 Okeechobee Boulevard within the Village Center. And we've already done the swearing in.
Right, great. I'll try to be brief with this one. The applicant is requesting a landscape waiver from Village Code Section 15-133 D2, single terminal islands. This code section requires each landscape island shall have at least 8 feet wide, exclusive of walkways and curbing. The applicant is requesting a landscape waiver from the section to allow a reduced landscape island width of 5 feet north of the dumpster and 3 feet at the southwest corner of the site where Village Code requires 8 feet, waivers of 3 feet and 5 feet respectively. Here's the location of those islands. The applicant contends that the landscape waiver is needed to accommodate the site improvements. Staff is recommending approval of this landscape waiver request. It generally concurs with the applicant's assessment, and staff believes that this is the minimum waiver necessary to allow the reasonable use of the property. Furthermore, the affected areas will contain all Village Code required landscape material for the terminal islands. The Planning and Zoning Commission considered this application on February 28, 2023 and recommended approval by a vote of 4-0. And again, staff is recommending approval of this waiver request, and I'll turn the floor back over to you, Mayor. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Does the applicant choose to make any comments on this item?
I'm happy to discuss it, but again, it was Mr. Brian outlined it. It's in this location right here and then adjacent to the dumpster. We can accommodate for the required tree plantings and landscape material that's required in those. It just, the full width of the island is not met at the 8-foot width. It staggers being slightly more narrow at one end, but larger than 8 feet on the other. So the average is still there. It just doesn't meet the technical code language of continuous 8-foot.
All right. Staff did recommend approval. But
Mr. Mayor, if I could, I was confused my thinking on R1, and I'd like to change my vote from nay to yay.
What's the procedure for that?
Make a motion to reconsider?
Motion to reconsider would have to be made by somebody on the prevailing side.
Right, on the... Right.
Somebody on the other side.
Somebody, one of the folks who approved it. Right. So that would.
It's not going to change the outcome.
I understand.
But if he wants to.
For the record, I mean, I made a mistake. And I'm trying to
change it for the
record. Correct the mistake.
Yeah. So.
How do I do that?
Be the Councilwoman, Vice Mayor, or Councilwoman Samuels to say retake the motion. How should she say it if she wants anyone?
So if anybody who voted yes wanted to make a motion to reconsider and that motion passed, that would allow the matter to be voted on
that's
again
you.
And allow Mr. Hamara to change his vote.
Okay.
Which would then presumably be 4-1 instead of 3-2.
Okay. I understand it doesn't change the outcome, but I'd like to correct my error.
Explaining the process. Yeah. That's why I think that's the best way to do it.
Okay. So...
We're going to finish this one first and then go back,
yeah,
or
do this thing
in
another way.
I'd rather fix it before we get further
okay.
in.
Yeah.
So, what do I say? I'd like us to reconsider agenda item
R1.
R1.
Can I just make one cautionary
yes.
thing here? The motion passed. That's just a desire.
Okay.
When you, if you bring it back up, y'all can vote differently.
I know. Yeah.
And that might not be, the, maybe some, I don't know, I'm not anticipating, but maybe there might be. Maybe two others might change their mind, and I don't know if that's a good idea.
This is what I was going to suggest. That's what I asked you with how we should handle it. We can mm-hmm. have that the record show that Councilman O'Mara go on the record saying that he has reversed his vote, and that's just for the record.
Well, he just misspoke. He thought
he
was going, he
yeah.
just okay. thought he was
so
going
it's
one way, and he went
so
the opposite.
Record.
If
so,
you're, if Mr. Hamara is satisfied with putting that on the record,
I am.
It'll be in the minutes that you
okay.
I understand
yes.
what Ray's saying.
Will
I,
not
yep.
change the outcome. So, and then
right.
we don't have to go through that exercise.
Right.
If you're satisfied with doing it that way, that you can do that as well.
Okay. Yeah, that's fine.
All right. So, Diane, let the record show that Councilman Hamara has indicated he has reversed his vote on that agenda item number one. Okay. We're good.
Thank you.
Okay. Were you speaking on that agenda item two?
No,
oh.
two, I'm good.
Okay.
I do have a question. If we can go, Bradford, do you mind bringing up the map? The just to show
the landscape?
The
areas
yeah,
of the
air,
landscape?
That they were asking
right.
for the landscaping. Yes, please.
Sorry, what happened?
I just wanted to ask, because I had a question about the landscaping variance
oh, okay.
and exactly what is it going to look like. So I understand what you're saying is, and either one of you can answer, for the dumpster and for the island number, so island number one, island number two, is it just because of the angle and the parking, because the parking spaces are already there, correct? Let's go to start with number two, landscape
so
island number two.
It's a, the landscape island number two is a result of the angled parking.
Okay.
And then the landscape island number one is a result of the dumpster and the angling of the dumpster because they're not stacked.
Yeah, they're not 90 degree
angled,
they're 45, right. Okay, but then the parking space that is adjacent to island number two is already there, isn't it? Or are we creating another parking space?
Those parking spaces are 90-degree angled parking spaces at this point in time.
That's landscape waivers. You want to make them 45.
We're having an enlargement if it's any easier to...
Yeah, why not?
Okay.
No, he's going to bring up something else because I didn't realize they're shifting the angle of the parking. So they're going from 90 degrees to 45 degrees, and that's why they have the variance.
There's no parking spaces there now. It doesn't look like from the aerial, and that was where the bank drive-through lanes were exiting.
It's not showing the right one.
Bradford, you have to relinquish.
Yeah.
It's just like being at home. Let it go.
It's not working? Oh.
It's a good thing I don't have dinner reservations.
I know it's in the same place every time.
So here are a couple little enlargements. So you can see that this is the location of the dumpster. And so, again, our 90-degree parking space, I believe, Bradford, you're right. I don't think there's actually parking spaces constructed in that location now.
Okay.
So, obviously, we're putting the size spaces with the island on the top as we bring them down. And then what you see is basically, on an average, if you were to mention from the midpoint, it's going to be 8. But it becomes less than that at the angle.
Because of the angle, right.
And then it's wider than that at the other end, right?
Sure.
So.
Right.
And then that's the same circumstance. Now, this is down in the very southwest corner.
That's on the other side. Angles.
And so, again, it's narrow here, but it's wider here. So, it's just because those narrow points.
Right. And I understand that then. So, is there an opportunity to add additional coverage or foliage in that wider spot? So, if we're giving you the variance and it's a tighter angle, can we I'm assuming the round ones are shrubbery.
Right, that's shrubbery. I mean, we could certainly add a couple of shrubs or supplement in that larger area around maybe the base of the tree if that were helpful.
Okay. I appreciate that. Thanks.
Yeah. All right, so what are we saying here? Is this a condition?
I'm asking if we do that we add additional greenery. I don't know if it needs to be specific as to a tree. I'm all for trees because of the shade, but I understand you can't because of that space.
Well, there'll be one tree in that space, and so in its maturity, there wouldn't be room for a second tree in that location. So we want one tree in each island, but we can certainly supplement it with some understory shrubbery.
And add more greenery, therefore. Okay. Go ahead.
What is the CL? What does that call out? Why don't we just add more of the CLs?
I don't recall off the top of my head what that one is.
I'll just add additional greenery. Is that greenery safe enough?
So we're just going to take, you see the call outs for the shrubbery that's there now?
Right.
We're just going to continue that shrubbery
and
then fill that space.
Right. We'll fill in these islands a little, to make them, again, full with material with the tree above.
Thank you.
Yep, no problem.
So is it just addition? I don't want to be too specific so that depending on what they put in there. So is it just additional shrubbery?
Yeah, you just put additional. We know the end.
You'll know what you're putting in. Okay. That would be my suggestion.
All right. So when we make a motion, we have to include this in that.
That would be the condition of approval
condition
with the motion.
Approval.
Yes, sir.
That's what I thought. Okay. Any comments, members, council? No? Diane, do we have any? No? Ray, any hands raised? All right. Did you want to comment on this agenda item, sir? No? Okay. All right, then I'm closing the floor to any additional public comment on agenda item R2, and if there's any more comments from members on council, I'll look for a motion.
I make a motion to approve regular agenda item number 2 with the addition of extra foliage in that area.
Condition of approval.
Condition of approval. Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? If no opposed, then please let the record show agenda item R2 was approved 5-0 with a condition. That was agreed to by the applicant. Okay, moving right along. Here we go now. agenda item R3 is public hearing to consider application 22-127. An application by Investment Equity Group 3 and an adoption of Resolution 23-01 confirming Council's action. The applicant is seeking a site plan modification, special exception use, and architectural approval to allow a restaurant with a drive-through for a property located at 11710 Okeechobee Boulevard within the Village Center. And you've already been sworn in for this agenda item, so Patrick.
Great. Thank you, Mayor. I wanted to just try to hit the highlights and some of the more of the technical stuff. We've been kind of walked around the site pretty good at this point in time. The proposed restaurant with drive-through is a special exception use approval within the zoning district, and we'll have a total of 2,519 square feet, which includes 298 square feet of outdoor seating. The intent is, again, to develop this as a Starbucks. This here is an illustration of the site plan. The proposed site improvements include a restaurant with drive-through, relocation of parking spaces to accommodate the required queuing area for the restaurant and drive-through, associated site landscape improvements. There will be an ingress off of Okeechobee Boulevard along the north property line, ingress egress through a cross access to the Denny's site, an ingress egress to the south of the site to Civic Center Way. Here is an illustration of the landscape plan, which meets village requirements aside from the landscape waiver request. We've been through the architectural of the site and the buildings. The special exception is for the drive-through, and here is the criteria for approving special exceptions. Overall, the proposed site plan and special exception and architectural meet all of the village's requirements for this type of use in the general commercial zoning district in regards to parcel size, parcel width, setbacks, pervious area, maximum building height, stacking and bypass, and design standards for the restaurant with drive-through of village code, with the exception of the parking variance and the landscape waiver. Staff is recommending approval of application number 22-127. And resolution 23-01 with the condition that regarding the proposed driveway entrance located on Okeechobee Boulevard, in order to prevent vehicles from queuing within the public right-of-way, the following conditions of approval is being requested. If during a 365-day period more than 10 independent safety incidents occur, Starbucks shall be required to modify operations up to and including closing the drive-thru in an effort to eliminate the future safety incidents. Safety incident shall be defined as a single occurrence where the on-site vehicle queue extends beyond the north property line for a period exceeding 10 seconds. Stage protests, traffic accidents, and village council approved special events shall not be counted as a safety incident. Also, safety incidents shall not be counted during the first 30 calendar days that Starbucks is open for business in order to allow for a grand opening. Again, staff is recommending approval of this, and I want to state that the Planning and Zoning Commission considered this application on February 28th with a vote of approval, with a vote of 4-0, with that same condition applying to the Denny's site, where if there is the stacking issues that were discussed for Okeechobee Boulevard, that operation adjustments shall occur to prevent that stacking onto the Denny's site.
You're saying if there's a stacking problem that infringes on the Denny's site? Is that what we're saying?
Both Okeechobee and to Denny's.
So staff is the entrance of Okeechobee not going into the street, right? Is that, and then it's the not creating a blockage for the Denny's customers.
The same stacking onto the Denny's site.
Here's my question. How do we enforce this?
Well, we'll have to witness it. Right? No. I mean, if there's
a stack, right?
No, if it's happening, we will know it. Okay. We will know it. I mean, we did not, the Planning and Zoning Board put it on for the Denny's because of the concern that the owner brought up at the Planning and Zoning meeting.
Right.
And we had it for Okeechobee, and we've done this on other drive-thrus. We've done it on the McDonald's. We've done it on.
We're doing it on the new DD's. Yeah.
I don't think we did it on the Dunkin' Donuts because they provided significantly more stacking distance, and they did it so it would stack within their property. But we've done it on Taco Bell. We've done it on McDonald's. And our concern was that, obviously, the Okeechobee Boulevard right turn lane and then stacking back into that lane. And so we would witness it. But if it's happening, we will know it, and we will witness it. And it has to happen 10 times. And then, right? Within a year.
Yep.
So it gives us plenty of opportunity to get with Starbucks and give them the opportunity to manage that drive-through differently.
And if I could clarify that the applicant, we worked through the condition of approval for Okeechobee Boulevard, and the applicant was in agreement of that condition. The condition that came up at the Planning and Zoning Commission, the applicant has yet to commit to that. Whether, you know, they are committed to it or not, I don't know. But just clarify those two.
Ask for clarification.
Go ahead.
Real quick. So, and maybe this is a good time to bring up your stacking slide.
Stacking slide, yes.
Just for visual. Yeah.
I don't know if I should, at what point I should speak a little bit about this, because this is a big deal for all of us, for you guys and for us. Right. Staff presented that language from presumably a city attorney. We reviewed it. We spoke with Starbucks. We're okay with it. At the end of the day, the reason that cars stack up is because they're being served too slow. When you boil it right down to the real brass tacks of what's happening, they're not getting them through quick enough. There are operational items that can be done to correct that. Whether the operator necessarily likes it is another thing, but if the choice is to adjust or lose your drive-through, then I think it'll help make their decision for them on how they govern themselves. What would not be acceptable, I don't believe, would be to put the same limitation across another personal private property line, where in effect we would kind of have a business trying to govern a business. Well, it sets up that won't be accepted.
I understand that, and I wouldn't want to put either one of you in that situation, but
and this is a big but, we actually do have a couple ideas that could help alleviate that from happening. And I don't know the best of it, even if you want to see the site plan now. But on the concern, first of all, this is just me personally in my general life, I try to get the easiest path, take the easiest path, which is a ride off Okeechobee.
Right.
Every single day of the week. It's difficult to drive through his parking lot. You have patrons, you have people backing in and out. It's not easy. You try to go the path of least resistance, and I personally don't think that is it. But we would be willing, and this would kind of take your participation on Civic Center Way. There's some medians in there, and I don't know if we could put some directional signage that would direct them all the way around to the rear entrance. Right. Listen, is that going to solve every single thing? Maybe not. Would that be very helpful? Absolutely. I think it would be. And I think between that and the fact that it's just not an easy movement, I think could be helpful all the way around for everybody.
Yeah, and I understand that. And I have a two-part question. I'm not sure, would you go through the process, then I'll ask that. But I do understand what you're saying, because specifically that Starbucks on 95 and Okeechobee, you're not going to turn in front of Einstein's to get into it. You're going to go right to the right turn only lane. So I understand that part of it. So for clarification then, and you can use your cursor or however you want to do it inside of it, but if you could indicate exactly how you anticipate the flow of traffic going through, and then what is your alternative if it does become backed up?
So briefly, just because this is what Ashley just alluded to as one idea that we contemplated and started talking about, what I've understood through the last, the comments that have been made, is that the concern is that people will be trying to access the drive-through through his parking lot and potentially going to create problems for his patrons. One of the suggestions we've made is really trying to create some directional signage, which you see often, especially in shopping centers, and this is maybe not one of those, but it certainly functions very similar to one where you have out parcels and you have the larger use and the civic use in the back. There's beautiful directional signage that you guys have done here within the complex. Mm-hmm. Maybe something similar could be done to where really it just, again, creates these drive, you know, their directional information to help to guide people away from the access here on Denny's, maybe around to back on Civic Center Way, to get them into the internal property that could help alleviate some of that choke that he's concerned about.
I think what's going to happen in that method is you're going to have that merging problem where people who are making the right-hand turn off of Okeechobee in that entrance-only way are going to, yep, if you come in that way and you have people who are going around that are coming up towards the north, from the south to the north, they're not going to let each other merge in.
You're saying in this circumstance, well, this person has a stop condition, right? This person will have to stop.
That person has to stop, but the people coming in there aren't stopping, and then that person who stopped is going to get upset and turn in. So that's where I think you have to do one or the other.
That's under the presumption that, you know, we're talking about, you know, 16, 17 cars are stacked up waiting for service, which is not what we anticipate to be the case. So, again, I think that this was proposed as a solution, I think, to alleviate the Denny's concern. And again, it would certainly take support from this council and the village to be able to do that. That's your public right-of-way. We can't install signage or do that inside your right-of-way. We would have to work together with you to accommodate for that.
So Bradford's out there, but why couldn't this, instead of going in there on Okeechobee, if we direct them to go at the western entrance on Civic Center Way, can't we make that, instead of making that an in, let's make it an out, and then it's a right turn only out? So that they're
About on Okeechobee?
You're saying still come in the same way that they're showing on Okeechobee?
Yeah. No. Yeah. Eliminate the coming in on that side.
Okay.
And make it an out only. And so if they come in on your, to your other picture, they're coming in on Civic Center Way.
Mm-hmm.
Here we go.
If they come in on Civic Center Way, then number one, it'll help with stacking on Okeechobee. It won't really happen. And then they go in, and then that becomes an exit only, not an entrance.
Don't allow the right turn off of Okeechobee?
They're not
gonna. Correct.
I'm saying
that's not going to. That's not going to work because they have to go through Denny's, right? Or if they don't, that's
going to. That will eliminate going through Denny's.
If you're exiting, are you speaking of exiting or coming? Coming or going?
Entering.
Entering
on the western side.
Okay. Yeah.
We're a Civic Center Way and doing this circle, going through the drive through and then going out where that entrance looks like, instead of that making that exit
only.
Oh,
I see what you're saying. I didn't understand.
Exit only.
So we would have to get approval through Palm Beach County to change the access to Okeechobee Boulevard. The county is, that's really against their standards to have exit driveway connections, egress onto turn lanes. It doesn't mean it's never been done, but that's actually against their access management standards.
Yeah, because someone's going to want to go across four lanes.
Now, what we could do is when they're leaving the drive-through, we can have signage directing them to exit to make a right turn, then another right turn to get to Civic Center Way. Because ultimately, they have to. They can't exit to Okeechobee Boulevard there. They have to get out to Okeechobee Boulevard, and that would at least reduce the amount of vehicles that are going through the Denny's cross access.
All right. So what you're saying is right now the way that's constructed is the entrance only?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
The one off of Okeechobee.
And so to change that to be entrance exit, we need...
The drive on Okeechobee cannot be changed. But the drive on Okeechobee is an advantage to not just the Starbucks. It works to the advantage of Denny's. It works to the advantage of the medical center and the new bank. That access, when you're going down Okeechobee Boulevard and if you pass Civic Center Way and then see the Denny's, you have an option of being able to pull in here and go to Denny's, and that movement is used. Then obviously they go to Starbucks too. Exiting Starbucks, there's going to be desire if you want to go eastbound on Okeechobee to go through the Denny's and out Civic Center Way. That is the shortest way to get back out.
Go back to head east.
But when we developed this site, which we did, the village did, and we created this cross access, that was our intent. That was our intent for these properties to be able to get across and then control the access on Okeechobee Boulevard. We didn't want a full access or a right in and right out that close to the Royal Palm Beach intersection.
Okay.
So we really don't want to encourage an exit out at okay. that particular
no,
location because you are dealing with the stacking of the cars at the signal. And it's better for them to go to Civic Center Way and turn right out.
Mm-hmm. And we can introduce signage at the exit of the drive-thru as well. No left turn or right only or combination thereof, you know, how, whatever would make the most sense.
So when you go through the drive-thru, and now I'm stopped, is your intent for them to make a right and go through the parking lot and go out on Civic Center Way? So, yeah, make a C-turn and then go back and
correct.
Go out that way. Okay.
If you go to Royal Palm Beach Boulevard, you have unrestricted
right.
movement. So you can get back to the light
and
go
either
wherever
way
you want.
We want. So I have my two-part question is, and I don't know if this is how to answer it, which part goes first. So I'm going to ask both questions, and then we can go from there. Is there on Civic Center Way, there's a median. Can that median be closed, number one? It's one of the questions. My second question is Mr. Livingston, do you find that your clientele comes through and makes that right on into your parking lot from Civic Center Way? If they had to go on the south side of the building and come back in, would that deter people from coming into your store and make that right-hand turn? So if that were closed and they had to go to the end and come up, would that be, because then that's going to alleviate people from not using that entrance on the right. They're not going to come down Civic Center Way to cut through your parking lot.
Well, I think one of the things, if they could have a more defined drive-through, so that would prevent people from trying to
cut through.
Yeah. Go make it a zipper.
Zipper.
Yeah.
So even, you know, I don't know, candlesticks or
right.
a curb or something, mm-hmm. that would stop anybody from coming in and trying to cut the line. That would be one easy, instead of signs everywhere, that would be the easiest thing to stop that part. I think a sign to make a U-turn and come back would help also. I mean, it's not going to prevent people from, you know, kind of cutting back through or whatever. I mean, you're never going to stop some people from
right.
doing that. So, you know, and they're still going to, if the traffic backs up on the south side by on Civic Center Way, waiting to turn right to get out to Okeechobee to cut through my entrance there and by my dumpster and go through
right.
to cut through people, that's gonna happen anyway. It's hard to stop that. But.
Because that's what I'm thinking. If I didn't have an opportunity to make a right on Civic Center Way, a left through your parking lot to get into Starbucks, I'm going to take Okeechobee to that entrance and go and bypass Denny's and go straight into Starbucks. And then that's going to alleviate people crossing using that cross access.
Closing the full access on Civic Center Way is not an option, though.
It is not an option.
It's not an option.
Okay.
And the reason it's not an option is because there's several, two businesses on the west side of Civic Center Way that mm-hmm. use that as a left turn in and left and a right out, so full access in and out. And Denny's uses that Civic Center Way as a full access in and out.
The pool place?
Yeah, the pool place and the realtor's
right.
office.
Yeah.
Right.
So you can't change the access like that mm-hmm. unless you had safety issue concerns at that location, and we do not.
At this point, anyway.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
I guess first question's a Ray question. You mentioned how we were the ones who did this and designed this. But when that was done, it was never contemplated having something like this, correct?
That is 100% correct.
Okay,
because
so this,
we also designed
so the fact
it
that
with,
we originally designed it, we completely
well,
changed
we,
the design.
Well, a couple things we did when we originally designed it. We did not allow for access off Okeechobee Boulevard. We did not allow for a drive-thru.
Right.
We have changed those two things since.
Right.
But the cross-access to the property, the Civic Center Way access, that was all in the original design.
But if I could also say something, too, it was approved for a bank, and at the time it was approved, banks were gigantic traffic drivers. It was a different world at that time.
Right. And secondly, if I don't know who this would be a question to, I guess Ray's an engineer. The path of least resistance someone talked about, now if you live to the south, and the way I'm looking at this design here, I'm heading north on Royal Palm Beach Boulevard. It seems to me the easiest way, if I want to go to Starbucks, I'm going to go to Civic Center Way. I'm going to go make a right, or no, I'm going to
yeah.
make a right in.
The first
I'm going to go up. I'm going to make a right into where Denny's is. I'm going to go north, and I'm going to make a right across the Denny parking lot because it seems like...
Why would you go that far, though?
Well, because I've got a right turn. and I've got the right of way where all these people, first of all, if I were to make this shortcut, I'm going to be up here at a stop sign having to make a left, competing with the people coming in off of Okeechobee. So I have to stop for them. I don't have to stop for these other people coming in, correct? Unless they put a stop sign there, I've got the right of way so I can cut the whole Starbucks line from these people going the long way or the short way, which is going to end up being the long way, and cutting off all the people from Okeechobee because I've got the right and they've got a left.
Which
will is that wrong?
In, which will insist in keeping the cars from stacking on the Denny's property.
Yeah. No, that'll said, make them stack on the Denny's property.
They have the right of way. They have the right of way.
Right, but they'll do you think those people making the left are going to let all those people stack across the Denny's? Oh, you've got the right of way. You can make that right.
Well, as compared to taking the right of way from them when you're at the stop sign, it's one or the other.
Or what we do is we take a page out of the Chick-fil-A handbook and you put an individual, a staff member on that corner and you have them help direct traffic.
I don't think I follow the full question. Okay, but if you're
not alone, I'm not following it either.
The path of easiest resistance. If you want to go into a Starbucks, and the Starbucks has a lot of stacking, if you make this first right from the south, I'm heading west, and you've got a little arrow going in to where I could go up to a stop sign and compete with the people who have the right of way over me coming in off of Okeechobee. So I got to stop and wait for them. They don't have a stop sign. So I'm waiting forever for the Okeechobee people. Why wouldn't I just go up and make a right and a right in Denny's where I have the right of way the entire time and I can cut not only these people who have to make a left, but I could also cut all the people who are coming off of Okeechobee.
But you have to not run over the people. I don't want to say that, but you still have to deal with the people in Denny's parking lot. Whereas here you don't. And
I think that would be more of a problem.
We have a stacking of 10 cars that are not in a drive lane at all that can fit around our building. In our design, we would have to have 13, 14, 15, whatever that would be. That's not an all-the-time occurrence by any stretch.
No, we need to, using signs or whatever, sticks, whatever methods we can use here, we need to do it in such a way that it's least optional to go all the way here and then go through the Denny's parking lot. That's what we want to avoid. And having the traffic go that route, the other route, that first right turn there, I think that's the way we need to try to design it so that that becomes the methodology that people follow.
You're talking about the entrance point on Okeechobee straight into...
No, I'm talking about coming in from Civic Center.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh.
Well, I drove over there before I came here. There is already a municipal directional sign, like really close to this area. I should remember if there was room for a Starbucks sign on there or not, which I don't. But if
you paid to have it rebuilt, there is.
I have a picture on my phone I should look at. But my point is, if I was able to maybe build two of those over here on Civic, I don't know. Again, I'd have to look at the picture I took. But I don't know if there would be room to fit Starbucks here. If I'm able to build the same sign over here where you guys can utilize that for, you know, whoever else you are.
But you know, the MD place does that on Okeechobee. If it's a directional, it's the little square directional sign. So I understand what you're saying with that. I don't think, Mr. Livingston, I'm trying to picture through, like, how would I do that and go through? And I don't see that where they're going through that side and doing it.
I don't either.
Wonder, though, making sure that as there is their staff will then go out and take the initiative to direct.
I see it happening when they're backed up onto Okeechobee and people are seeing that it's backed up, so they're going to come around ahead of time to jump the line. I see it happening.
But that's not going to fly them backing up.
I understand what you're saying there, but even if they do that, those people are not letting them in.
Well, I mean, I don't know what they are, but they're creating a second drive-through coming through. That's why I said just to, if they could put something up to define the drive-through going curving away from Denny's, then that's going to prevent that from happening. Period.
Like PVC pipes or something like that.
Or curb, you know, just something to plants or something.
Because otherwise it's wide open. insofar as coming at it from so many different directions.
That way, they won't.
No, that is. No,
you know, I'll tell you, though, Costco does that in direction when they started going in through the parking for the gas station.
Sure. I can get into some of the queuing calculations if we'd like. It may help address some of these items, if I may, because we actually have data from Starbucks and actual queuing.
All right, we're looking at, right now we're looking at, this is the one I wanted to see.
Yeah.
These are the numbers of cards, how many cards are stacked
up
here?
So this is our capacity, so I want to be clear on this. So we can circulate all around the Starbucks, not all drive-thrus are set up where you can utilize kind of the full restaurant. Fortunately, we're able to do that and have that bypass lane. So on-site, we have a design right there for about 10 cars. Maybe we can get 11 if someone's coffee's ordered run. We can set them up a little bit forward and they wait. Yeah, right. So we have about 10, 11 spaces right there. So the capacity then goes, if going straight out to Okeechobee, you can get another 6 vehicles there. And then going down the drive aisle, the one you can see where it says 17, 18, 19, obviously there's more stacking that way. The reality is not everybody's going to be coming from Okeechobee Boulevard. Talking about the path of least resistance, if you're on Royal Palm Beach Boulevard, you're not going to be going to the Okeechobee Boulevard entrance. You'll be going through Civic Center Way.
This is exactly the route I would take if I'm coming from Royal Palm Beach.
I want to get into the queuing calculations because we actually
have because
data for
this.
I want to be clear. This is capacity that we're showing,
not what we expect
expectation.
To be. Okay.
Expectation. So when we are required when we do a site, we submit to Palm Beach County Traffic for traffic concurrency approval. So this is a standard item. When we submitted to traffic, and Okeechobee Boulevard is obviously a Palm Beach County road, they actually had a question about the queuing because they look at the site plan, they look at our traffic, and they said, we need to see some a queuing analysis, queue data for this. So I did not collect the queue data, but I actually have another professional engineer that happened to have Starbucks queue data done recently. So I was able to get that information, and I want to go over those numbers for you. Now, they were geographically a little bit different, but they were similar, and I'll explain. So they collected them on two different locations. The locations were in Stewart and Port St. Lucie. So I want to be clear on that. Now I understand there's a geographical difference. But the one in Stewart was on US 1, and it happened to be a similar type site in the sense that it was on a corner. There was another smaller road, more like Royal Palm Beach Boulevard, and then in US 1. If you combine the daily traffic for those two roadways that it was on in Stewart, it is very similar to the daily traffic that is here on Okeechobee and Royal Palm Beach Boulevard. Similarly, the queue data was done at a Starbucks with drive-thru, obviously, up in Port St. Lucie. It was done on Port St. Lucie Boulevard, a 6-lane roadway with high traffic volumes. The traffic volumes were actually a little bit higher than if you combined both daily traffic of Okeechobee and Royal Palm Beach Boulevard here. So, yes, they were different. And look, it was, Martin County and St. Lucie County. But from an operational standpoint, the daily pass-by traffic, all that very, very similar. So I feel good about those numbers. So the maximum queuing that was observed at any one time was 12 for one site and 13 for the other site. And I want to be clear on that. That is a moment in time. Throughout most of the day, most of the morning, it was much, much less than that. That is the maximum queue. So that is our expectation of what could occur for a couple minutes during peak time, is that we would potentially get 12 or 13 vehicles possibly at the site. So we do not believe that this is a constant issue where it's stacking up to Okeechobee Boulevard. We don't anticipate that type of queue. Obviously, we have conditions of approval that Mr. O'Brien went over. And I do want to mention Palm Beach County did look at what we provided. They have a concern for Okeechobee Boulevard. Obviously, they would get complaints about it if there was issues. And they issued the traffic approval letter. So we have the concurrency approval from Palm Beach County. We have this queue data, which shows 12 or 13 vehicles. And then, this is kind of the belts and suspenders of the having this condition with approval. So all this discussion about possibly, merging in with all this stuff, if that happens, that means we're queuing onto Okeechobee Boulevard. And we have to fix it anyway. So that's what the condition of approval says. So we feel, and I certainly recognize the concern. We've all been through, drive-thrus that can certainly get busy. But we do feel very confident in not only design, but the data analysis that we've provided.
Bradford, I don't know if you can answer this question. Thank you very much. What is the distance from the entrance, that Okeechobee right turn only entrance, till you get to the corner of Royal Palm Beach Boulevard and Okeechobee? Because that's a right turn only lane going forward, heading east of that spot. So roughly how many cars do you think, and you know, if that's easier to figure out then.
The deceleration lane?
The right-hand turn only lane. So what my concern is also is if cars do back up or if I'm that number 16 car.
How deep
car,
is it?
I want to know how, what's the distance from car number 16 to the corner?
Right. Are you talking about this width or this length?
No, head east, head east.
On Okeechobee Boulevard.
I would guess about 200 feet. That's kind of a ballpark.
I was going to say, not specific, but if I'm trying to make a right on Royal Palm Beach Boulevard, am I now stuck behind car number 17 because I'm trying to get around?
Trying to get to make the right turn.
Correct.
Got it. Okay.
Absolutely. So that's where, is that space there? Right. Yeah. Wait till you're driving West Palm.
Unless you decide, I may as well get some Starbucks while I'm online.
Yeah.
Well, that's what the condition's for, right? If that happens,
right.
Well, then it's going
to have to address.
Yeah, that would be
addressed.
Right. Well, even if it was 500 feet, you can still have us adjust our operation.
Got it.
I mean, so you follow, you know.
I understand what you're saying is that you're going to adjust production internally to prevent the external.
In the right way is bad, you know, no matter the condition, really. Well, so.
Here was the question I was going to ask before, and you kind of touched on it when you said that one of the things the operator can do is be more efficient in how quickly they service these customers, right, to keep the line moving. Does the placement of the menu board have an impact on that issue?
That's a great question.
I'm definitely not a restaurant operator.
I know.
Starbucks, however, that is their business, they are incredibly specific about the placement of those menu boards. So I think, yes, it does have an effect in how quickly you can get through. And they will not do a site if it doesn't meet their criteria, which this falls into the placement that they would like to see.
Well, there's a point you raised earlier. You used the term the Chick-fil-A model, right? And this was something that they put in place in response to, you know, COVID and everybody not wanting to go into the restaurants, where they had people out there with their little computers taking the orders, okay, way back in the beginning of the queue. So the orders are in, and then it's just a matter of them servicing them. I don't know, you know, if that
Chick-fil-A
really makes a difference.
Chick-fil-A does a tremendous amount of business. Mind-boggling, quite honestly, if you've ever actually sit there and watch.
That might be something that the operators of Starbucks might want to consider, certainly if they find themselves in jeopardy because of the conditions of approval aren't going in the right direction for them.
Right. Again, I think they're going to consider every available option not to have their drive-thru.
No, and I also think because of the app, I've spoken to people who have the Starbucks app that are ordering, and then when they go to the drive-thru, it's already ready, or it's stopped and it's waiting and ready for them.
Yep.
I just want to make sure,
you can pick it up,
Mr. Livingston, that it still isn't a concern.
Yep.
The condition part of it that I'm worried about, and I don't know if I understood this correctly, is that could any of the local businesses call in as one of those 10 times a year, or is that on us? Because I don't think that's right. If
I think that what the circumstance would be would be that Denny's would have a observed complaint.
Yeah.
We would come out and verify with our own staff.
See, and that's what I'm wondering, if there are peak times that Starbucks has, if maybe, not to put the onus on code enforcement, but if they're out 24 hours or if they're out 7 days, I'd rather it not be one business to.
That's why I asked the question earlier, how do we enforce it?
Yeah, if we can do it versus.
Figure out a methodology where we are at least doing that to see what the results are. And after the first 30 days, I think it starts. Okay.
I know we've talked about the in, getting in there and the stacking going in, but now looking at this photo going out, so if I'm number one and I got my order and I'm ready to go and I see that there's, you know, no space between 10 and 11 because they've blocked the driveway, I now am going to turn right, go back down the driveway south to go to Civic Center Way to go out.
But we want to put signage in to make that the traffic flow. That's the desired result that we want to see happen there. Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
from the very beginning, okay. And a year and a half ago when you guys came in with this, my biggest concern was that traffic backed up on Okeechobee. Yeah. Right, so they've perfected that in the last year and a half to help with that. That honestly, I think, is the biggest concern that I have.
I think the other one, though, is if you see that stacking, like if you're that red car and there's cars blocking you, you're not going to park to go in.
No, you're not.
You can't park from 11
through. Yeah.
Yeah. And you can't park where 17, 18, 19.
Look at the new DDs. That's exactly the problem. Yeah. But that's why he made the point of telling us this is a capacity drawing, not a performance drawing.
Sure.
So
sure.
We'll see, right?
So, but to your point of we'll see, I mean, I think, again, we try to think through a variety of different solutions. Another slide I'd like to show you, again, there's operational how they serve their patrons. Is this it? It's down here. So again, we were just brainstorming ideas, and this isn't, you know, this is something we were thinking about. Look, in the reality, in a worst case condition where that was occurring, this is very typical. Your scene is done. Obviously, Chick-fil-A has probably they're the ones who are doing this in most conditions. But look, there is a clear way that if that is problematic, that can be in those peak moments. Let's say it's 30 minutes from 7 to 7:30 on Thursdays when this occurs.
Right.
You know, that you would limit that turn so that you're circulating the cars around, tripling the length of your queue if it were necessary to be done.
Here's my question on that, though. Who what you're giving up, though, is the option for those customers to park their car and go inside. We're clear on that, right? This is showing.
You're still working your way into those locations where you could still park your car.
No, not if you're coming in off Okeechobee Boulevard.
Well,
Well, there's some spots over here if you make a left. But I'm just pointing that out. All right. It
impacts
that store, that operation. Sure. It's not impacting Denny's. It's not impacting the other building on the right. It's just impacting them and their customers.
So they can make that decision.
So they got to deal with the customers that would be upset with them saying, I had nowhere to park when I came. Okay.
Can you follow that arrow now, that first arrow that you have right in front that just enter the drive-through? And he makes, you make the C turn. Are you now making an S and going back to the, and now making a right and trying to go out on Civic Center
Way?
Yeah, you
can say, again, this is pretty diagrammatic.
I was going to say, okay.
No, I'm saying, so if I'm at that point now, I have my drink and I'm ready to go, how do I get out of that line?
How do I get out?
You can make a C.
You'll still be able to go right. And we need to, again, I mean, I kind of see one direction.
Yeah, the reality is this, though.
You're
going
to hit that car.
We'll have to park further. They have to have a lane. They have to create a lane where they have the right lane and there's a left lane that opens up for them to exit out of. Otherwise,
that's what I'm asking, though. I've now gone through. I'm car number
one. So what you should be showing is the arrows going the other way of the folks coming out. All right, because
you just have to make a sharp U-turn and then go out
to
the center.
You make the same turn that you would make on a typical day.
But this was just one possible.
Yeah, correct. Yeah.
Right, this was just an idea. Again, we wanted to, be completely transparent here. We're trying to show you that there's a lot of different solutions to the concerns that are being raised in the condition that's been applied to the project, that we have to address it, and we think we have solutions on how to address it in that very worst case situation if it were to occur.
All right, so I think you mentioned earlier, I just want to be clear that the operator has accepted and agree to the conditions of approval that were passed on, right?
Well,
is it one condition?
We're in agreement to the condition. Well, there's multiple conditions of approval, but specific to this issue, we're in agreement to the condition of approval to the monitoring or
monitoring.
The adjustment for Okeechobee Boulevard.
Results.
But as was mentioned, it's not something that we could agree to from a business to business.
And they understand a fail means they could lose the driveway.
We do understand.
The drive-through.
It's included within their
list. Okay, I just want to make sure we're clear on that.
The exact language given by staff.
Keith, you want to add anything to that?
To the last comment, as you'll see in the backup, Exhibit B to the proposed resolution has pages of conditions of approval. I know we've been speaking all about this one, but I would want to make sure that the applicant is in agreement with all the conditions as presented.
Yes, that is, we are in agreement with all conditions, okay. Save the one item that was this new condition that was suggested at PZAB.
That's not in the document, is that correct? Okay, so we're talking about what's in the document. Right, okay, good. Any other comments, questions?
Just for clarification then, so it's the condition that you're okay being monitored through the drive-through.
The exact language is what we're in agreement
to. Okay.
Yeah.
But now in that condition, does it say it can be a business-to-business?
No.
Okay, no, that's what I wanted to make sure.
That was not, okay, that, yeah, that was not agreed to.
Suggestion. Gotcha. Right. That's what, okay. Are you, go ahead, I'm listening.
So there's no way to make the drive-through more
defined?
Yeah.
I think that's what we did talk about, though, is that, like, where space number 10 is that, was it coning or directing that I think Starbucks, is there a way of directing cars into that spot? So you can't come, basically where car number 10 is, I can't come from the west. I can only come from the north.
I mean, it's a cross-access easement that is in place that has to be maintain access in both directions.
I'm not asking to block that. I'm saying, you see where car number 10 is? And you see how there's a walkway? Do you understand what
I understand. Yeah. And what we're kind of talking about is channelization. You do it for like right turns and stuff like that. And I certainly understand. The issue is we have two southbound lanes. Because you have the bypass lane to exit the parking, you can't channelize it there. Otherwise, you block people from making a left to get into that bypass lane. So there's no practical way to do it based on this configuration.
What do you mean?
The conversations we had about, you know, different signage, et cetera, do we need to, does that need to be codified some way in terms of what that means? How does that evolve?
The signage that's part of the site plan approval, and the signage is designed to encourage the people going westbound on Okeechobee Boulevard to come in this right turn only. People coming up Royal Palm Beach Boulevard, when they learn the route, they will be turning into Civic Center Way to go there. The ones coming from the east to go there will either turn on Royal Palm Beach Boulevard, which we'll is most likely what they will do.
I would think so.
Or they'll have to go to the left turn at Civic Center Way and go through the Denny's, or wrap all the way around and come in the back way. So I think the last choice is to turn left in the Civic Center Way and go that way. So, I mean, it's just the logical way to go, because you can come up Royal Palm and Civic Center Way is going to be clear, and it's going to be the quickest way to get in there.
Right.
So,
and people, once they learn the lay of the land, we'll know that, and it'll be a learned, you know, solution. Actually, I think, because that's what I do. Okay. Any other comments, questions on this topic?
Because I don't want it to impact other businesses as well. So
now when it does build up, there's no recourse for me at all, because if they can agree that it's business to business, it affects it into my property, that's my business.
No, but I think we were talking about that, is that would it be that we would have it monitored a different way?
We need, and you certainly will let us know.
Have it monitored, but just not having... No, they didn't want you to, other businesses, I'm sorry, I should have said other businesses monitor, monitored.
You let us know if that's an occurrence.
Anybody can let the village know, but the village has to be the entity that does the enforcement.
Right. That's correct. And that's the whole point on that. Okay.
All right. Makes sense.
Do we have any public comments, any advanced comments on this? No? I'm sorry, I didn't ask that earlier. Ray, any hands raised? Okay, I have no further public comment cards submitted on this agenda item, so I'm closing public comment at this point. And unless there's additional comments or questions on members on council, I'll look for a motion.
I approve regular agenda item number 3.
What's the motion?
Make a motion.
Oh, motion to approve.
I approve. You know why? Because in my head I'm going, I cannot believe that I've approved three. Yeah, no. Three variances in one meeting.
You're on a roll tonight, Selena. You're good. All right, we have a motion.
All right, second.
We have a motion and a second for agenda item R3. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? We have no opposed. All right. So, Diane, let the record show agenda item R3 was approved, 5-0. And
thank you all.
Let's make this work. Let's make it work for your neighboring restaurant as well. And we'll move forward from here. Thank you. I appreciate
thank you
your
for
comments.
Taking into consideration.
Listen, we hear you. We want you to know that, okay? All right. Okay. What's the timeline before you guys open your doors? Six months, 8 months, year? Okay. Okay. So fourth quarter we're looking at. Yeah. Okay. Good luck. Let's make this work for everyone, okay? Okay. All right. Moving on. Regular agenda item R4, the public hearing for first reading and approval of ordinance number 1033, amending chapter 23, traffic and vehicles, at section 23-16, manner of parking vehicles upon streets, public rights of way, publicly owned parking spaces, vacant lots and swells, penalties to clarify the swell parking restrictions within the village and add additional regulations to address parking of vehicles on publicly owned property. Boy, we're covering a lot of ground here. Break it down for us, please.
Keith.
So that was
take the breakdown.
I was following along, Mayor. You did a good job of reading the title. This ordinance does a couple things. An issue that the village has been dealing with is our code requires on-street parking to be parallel with the direction of traffic.
Yeah.
And there have been people who have said that, have argued that diagonal parking in this equals parallel parking. So.
What school they go to? Yeah, that's.
So this would add language that specifically says parallel means parallel.
Parallel means parallel. Okay. Okay.
So it adds that.
And they still have to face the right direction.
Yes.
Okay.
It changes the, right now the code says no vehicle will be allowed to remain stopped or parked in the street adjacent to private property longer than 24 hours. This would change it to 2 hours without the permission of the adjacent property owner. Clarifies you can't block an adjacent property owner's access, no overnight parking in the street. And then we've kind of reorganized this section. It continues to list certain streets in the village where no overnight parking in the swale is allowed. And, that's Crestwood, Royal Palm Beach Boulevard, Southern Boulevard, State Road 7, and Okeechobee Boulevard. So that's...
Kind of main drags.
Yes. Okay. So then we actually don't have a code section apparently that addresses motorized vehicle parking on village-owned property. So there's a new code section that says motorized vehicles can only park in designated parking spaces or as allowed by posted signage on village-owned property.
How did that come about? It's because we don't have any parking spaces because of the construction?
I don't know where the specific area is. I know this is a Rob Hill ordinance, so he currently had an issue somewhere.
Motorized vehicles include scooters, those electric scooters?
That would have a motor.
Okay. All right. People park in
golf carts wherever they want.
Right now, we don't have any place. We're building until we get through all the construction. Things should be a lot better, I would think. But a lot prettier, too. Okay,
That's the essence of this one.
Okay. Before we take comments from council, any advance Public comment? No? Ray, anyone have their hand raised out there? I'm sure there's a lot of people concerned. No? Okay. I have no public comment cards on this agenda item, so I'm closing public comment, opening up for comments from members of council.
I just have a quick question regarding how does this affect homeowners whose property is on a corner and or on a turn? So we have some of our roads, you know, where they're on the end of a cul-de-sac or a bend in the street.
Bond Street would be adjacent on both sides of the corner, so it would apply.
Doesn't treat them any different.
I understand, but what if there isn't any room? So if I can park parallel next to my property, and because I have the space, what happens, though, if I live on a bend, and now my property is like a pie shape?
You cannot park in front of someone else's property for more than 2 hours without their permission, or you can't park in their swale. So if you're in the inside of a pie, and you have a very limited front yard, you have basically very little on-street parking. And that is the problem we're trying to solve here.
That is, yeah.
We have some people that are in that situation that go park in front of other people's houses.
Yeah. So don't do that
without their permission. Well, 2 hours.
No, I understand that, and I wouldn't want them doing that. I'm just trying to figure out now how is it that, where are we telling them to park? So if I have
on their property. Not in front of other people's
houses. Okay, so then they can pull up on the sides for the 24 hours if they're having or 12 hours, whatever it is. I'm having a cocktail.
2 hours.
I'm having a Final Four party.
No.
And I live on the corner. Now what do I do?
The 2 hours is so when you're having parties. If you're having people over for an evening gathering, you can go park in front of your neighbor's house. Can't park in his swale, but you can park in front of his house.
But for the 2 hours.
That is correct.
Yeah. Unless you invite the neighbor to your event, then...
Just get permission. Talk to your neighbor.
Right.
That's always a good option.
Good, Jeff. You got questions? No? Okay, you know my question, right? The enforcement of this. So somebody's parked in front of me for 2 hours or 2 hours and 1 minute. What I do, call PBSO?
No, it'll be a code enforcement.
So I'll report it the next day to code enforcement? Because they're not going to be around at like midnight, right?
Take video, Fred.
If it's a one-time occurrence, then the problem's solved. It's really the person that does it all the time. And code enforcement will get involved, and code enforcement will cite
Take pictures. Richard's serious.
Well, our code enforcement will have to witness it, and they will. The problem is not the cars that just come park for a little while and take off. It's the ones that leave them there for days. They're the
really?
Ones, yeah.
Days. Yeah. Okay. All right. We'll see how that works out. Any other comments, members on council? Did I ask for public comment? Ray, no waste.
No,
I received no public comment cards on the agenda item all five, so I'll close the public comment. Right. Any comments from council? If not, I look for a motion.
Motion to approve regular agenda item R4.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All opposed? All four?
Aye.
Favor, aye.
Any opposed? We have no opposed, Diane. Let the record show agenda item R4 was approved. 5-0. Our fifth agenda agenda item is a public hearing for first reading and approval ordinance number 1018, amending chapter 26, zoning at section 26-22, definitions. To modify an existing definition and add three entirely new definitions to section 26-57, accessory uses, buildings and structures, model homes, vehicle auction sales, electric vehicle charging stations. Wow, we're there. To classify the setback regulations for the sheds and play structures with design features exceeding 8 feet in height, and add additional regulations for sheds, accessory structures over 150 square feet in detached private garages. Wow. You read us, Brian?
We had some definitions. We had a definition for accessory structures. And one of the things that we are saying here is a pod or a cargo container cannot be used as an accessory structure. You can't bring one of those in and convert it into some other thing. You can use it as they're intended under the regulations that we have, but you can't turn it into some permanent accessory structure.
Okay.
We had defined what a detached garage means. We actually have a definition for principal structure and a definition for shed. Couple of the other things this ordinance does, clarifies the setback requirements for sheds and play structures when they exceed 8 feet in height. It increases the setback requirements if they're that big, and it requires any accessory structure that's bigger than 150 square feet, it has to architecturally match the design features of the primary structure. So if you have this big, a larger accessory, it has to have siding, color, stucco, whatever, like that. Provide size, accessibility, and setback requirements for detached private garages. And it limits the size of a shed on a single family lot to 150 square feet. And the shed has to be no higher than the principal structure. So if you're going to have a shed, can't be bigger than 150 square feet.
That's about 12 by 12.
Yeah, and it can't be higher than
8 feet.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that's this one.
Okay. And my question on this is, okay, if we approve this, what happens to people who are currently not compliant?
Yep. That was my question.
Same as any time you've not created, if they put in what they have, and when they put it in, it was lawful, you've created a legal non-conforming structure, which is allowed to remain until they want to do substantial improvements.
It's just going forward. Okay. All right. Okay.
Now, if what they put in is not allowed now.
Well, no, that's a different. No, I'm just talking about the rules for the new rules.
It would be a legal non-conformity, and it would be allowed to remain.
Okay.
Okay, so that was one of my questions. My other question is how many more variances is this going to create for us coming through?
That I can't tell you.
It shouldn't create any.
Well, it's going to create a bunch because now it's, well, I have this, and it's not, now I need a variance to have it done.
Well, now that you're granting them all, it's going to be a lot more.
No, well, it's that, no, because unless they go to change it. But the other part is then how many are going to.
Just say no.
Okay.
No.
Yeah.
No, I listen.
Because they're going to come in and say, you know what, I did it. Now they're asking for forgiveness instead of permission.
Well, that's a different problem, though. If
that's
they went
the
and did
thing.
It and didn't, know what the rules were.
Right. Well, we've had it where they.
We've had that. I know we've had that happen.
Yeah. And
how
the swing
long,
set,
well,
and the kids come in.
But we have that happen, and we ask, well, how long has this been like this? Oh, we built this 20 years ago, and now we're just now.
That's something different.
Yeah.
It's the one of
okay.
where it's the swing set, and then the children come in and say, please don't tear down
please
my
don't
swing
tear
set.
I know. We've been there. We used to have that.
Those are,
right. Okay.
So I'm wondering if we're creating more.
Well, I think we need to do it because I think there's been some violations going on, and because we didn't have the right rules on the books, we can't control it.
So,
the reason for this is a large building should meet the setbacks of the zoning district. We have made exceptions to that for accessory structures. Sheds. We let sheds go in the back corner of the property, 10 feet. It's not 20 feet or 30 feet off or 25 feet off. When you come in, if you come in with a 400 square foot garage and want to meet the accessory structures, when we don't have a lot of these requests, but we were seeing it. We're seeing it happen, and when you start, we're getting built out.
Yeah.
So people are looking for area to build.
Right.
So then they were confusing, they were starting to want to confuse the line between accessory structure and another major structure. And we're wanting to head it off before it happens.
Okay. Let's blame it on COVID. But okay.
There's a song in there somewhere.
Any other questions? Yes. Does anyone have a comment on this? No?
No comments, Mayor.
Okay. Any hand raised?
No.
I've received no comment cards on agenda item 5. Closing public comment. Mm-hmm. Any members of council have additional questions or not? If not, I'll look for a motion.
I'll make a motion to approve regular agenda R5.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. All approved?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Diane, let the record show agenda item R5 is approved 5-0. And guess what?
That's it.
That's it. We stand adjourned. Thank you all.